piece I'd never finished because I had no time. So I was like, oh, it's landscape day. So I just grabbed this old Indian piece I had never done.
That's cool.
And I was just going to, yeah, because I just figured I'd do a landscape demo or something. Yeah. Something a little different.
That's rad.
Yeah, it'll be fun.
And then, so tonight's the drawing session?
Yeah, we'll do 5 to 8.
Cool.
So we'll do this from... and, you know, I think Jeff Delier might be stopping by because I didn't know who would be here to read. And you're more than welcome to do it.
Yeah.
Also,
the questions.
Just the questions. Yeah, because they're going to be coming in. And Greg's going to run up and get my airbrush, which I left at the studio.
Oh, gotcha.
Up there from last term. So.
I'm going to use the bathroom quick.
Yeah, it's right there. Straight through there. Is that my phone or yours?
Yours.
Hello everybody out there. So we're doing this a little differently this time. It's on a Wednesday, obviously, instead of a Friday night live. It's gonna be a Wednesday night live. For some of you, it's gonna be a little bit better because we're kind of on break between our terms right now. So we are you know, doing things kind of out of sequence a little bit, and I'm getting ready to leave to go to Canada tomorrow, so I won't be able to do it on the Friday. That's why we ended up switching it to Wednesday. But anyway, no big deal. So what I thought I'd do today, each week, every time we do these live streams, we'll mix it up a little bit and just show different areas of strengths of the school, the atelier, of also my own training. This is actually a little narrative piece that I'm going to do. I was going to do a landscape, and I found this illustration sample that I was going to do for a fine art piece. We've got three Indians here in the middle, and my reference is up here. And it's not great reference, it's because it was a comp. It was basically designed to be a preliminary for a larger painting. So this is the way I normally work up my pieces. And I use gouache because it's such a fast medium and forgiving. And I can tell whether or not where the problems are going to be in the bigger painting when I do it in oil. Also, I can understand better, any problematic areas that might need to be reshot, redesigned. And I'd rather do it in a 2-hour study than on a 100-hour effort. So anyway, as I get started here, I have my preliminary drawing here, which is really just sketched in, projected in. And I use a projector a lot of times because I don't really want to spend the time to freehand. Some of it's freehanded. Sometimes I'll freehand draw the guys on horseback, changing little aspects of their positioning, things of that sort, in order to... And I have a little purple left on this thing, which is, again, I don't really care. But this is just to wet down the board. Now, normally I would do this horizontally and not vertically, but I don't want to take it off here and you wouldn't be able to see what I was doing. So you can do it vertical. It's just not quite as ideal. So it's just illustration board. And again, I did not fix the drawing because I don't want it getting all washed out and taking, it'll beat up. If you use spray fixative on gouache, gouache doesn't go over it very well. So I usually like to just use an HB pencil or an H pencil so that it's pretty hard in there and it won't come off anyway. So what you want to do is get a pretty generous amount of water over the surface. Now, if you're using a cheaper board, it'll potato chip up on you when you do this and start kind of bowing. So you want to kind of use the 110, the 100 crescent. I'm not a huge fan of crescent, but I don't have an alternative really right now. Their boards have been peeling a little bit lately on me, and I don't know if it's just a bad batch or something, but that's what I normally use, is the crescent 110, 114, 100. The 114 is hard to get. It's really thick watercolor board, but it's very expensive and probably hard for many of you to find, so I wouldn't worry too much about that. Gouache will go down on any number of different surfaces, so just as long as it can handle water washes like what I just did, you should be fine. So now in general, what I would normally do if I was doing a big oil painting or something is kill the white of the canvas as quick as possible with local stains. Stains meaning diluted versions of colors. So it would be a diluted reddish tone or something. There's a lot of red rock. This is up in the Sierras. But for all practical purposes, from a narrative standpoint, it could be Wyoming, it could be Colorado, it could be any number of different places. And so I want to just preface that by saying that it's not that big of a concern of mine, with the Indians. You know, you, again, if you were specifically wanting to do a narrative that talked about where, in particular, these particular Indians were from, then you would want to do a little research and make sure that, yes, there was red rock in that area, and that might not look too foreign or out of place. But we're not worried too much about that for the example, this example that I'm doing. So what I'm going to do is just taking a flat brush and just putting in diluted versions of localized color. Now, the red being so prevalent in the rock, I could have had two choices. I could have put a green underneath it and allowed it to come through in the stain later to help it harmonize. I can also do this red treatment in the green, pine trees, which would come through and also help to make for a very interesting kind of some greens coming, or some reds coming through the greens, which will harmonize really well. But right now I'm more interested in just sprinkling around some abstractions of color. This is not a scientific thing for me. This is not, I don't hyper-analyze it, hyper-obsess about it. I just use my intuition and my logic to dictate. And again, that's going to be some of your best best things, is just the ability to actually just relax and use common sense. You know, if you want to do analogous color, then you'd put green and greens together, you know, a lighter diluted green, and then later put a darker green over it. That would work fine also. So it's not so much which one's, you know, perfect, but what, you know, there's lots of options. Now that green, I might just go right over the guys on horseback, the Indians here, and just let that be the stain that goes over them. Again, not too concerned about it. Just don't want to make this stain phase really meticulous and fastidious and uptight. That's just the way I work. Now you may want to do that. That's fine. Everybody's a little different, and everybody has to kind of through time kind of discover their proper sequence for building up paintings.
Hey Jeff, just so you know, a lot of people are enjoying the fact that this is earlier.
Oh, are they?
Yeah.
Well, good. I'm glad you guys. I don't mean to, you know, again, a lot of times you can watch this, you know, on the back end after it's, you know, for a while. We've been keeping them up, so on YouTube. So if you do miss one, you usually have a couple days or a week or two to kind of watch it. But I it is kind of fun to watch it, probably in its original, like when it's being done. I mean, that's kind of neat. But I'm glad you guys are enjoying that. No worries. So the water is a very turquoisey, kind of greenish, got a lot of, so this is Windsor green or Thalo green, depending on the brand you're using. It used to be called Thalo, and Windsor Newton, for some reason, which is beyond my understanding, they switched it to Windsor. They changed the name. It's still Thalo green in some brands, and in other brands it's Windsor, well, mostly Windsor Newton, it's Windsor green. But it's still Thalo, which is a very staining dye color. So it's very dangerous. Meaning that, you know, it can infiltrate into other colors and swallow them live, you know, swallow them up, and it's hard to combat it because there's not many colors that have the strength to counter some of the dye colors. So just be careful when you're using them, because sometimes they can be a little annoying if they permeate too much into areas of your painting that you didn't want them. But you'll get a pretty quick handle on which ones those are. Again, they're mostly quinacridones, dye colors, thalos, thalo blue, thalo green, alizarin crimson, daxanine purple. These are the ones that will wreak havoc on your painting if you're not pretty strong at controlling. Yeah, and so, you know, you might want to avoid them if you're a newer painter until you get your chops up a little bit down the road. Then you can venture into using them. So again, at this stage, it's primarily a watercolor. I mean, it's sloppy watercolor, but a watercolor. I'm not as concerned about leaving strategic whites like I would if I was using watercolor. So I'm mostly just building up my painting in small diluted, arrangements of value and color. And it's a very fun, simple part of the phase. I mean, some people find it very boring because it's like, oh, I just want to get to painting. I want to get to the fun stuff. I see it as a meditative time to just kind of collect my thoughts and get familiar with my subject if I haven't already done so. Usually by this time I've already done preliminary pencil sketches. I've done that's just way too small of a brush for that. Pencil sketches. I've done numerous different iterations of drawings and positioning and trying to find the right reference for the Indians or for whatever. This could have been very easily some other topic or subject. If you guys are more concept visual development guys, these could be a bunch of a landing party from the future or something. You got all kinds of, you could have tech involved, all kinds of fun stuff. But the imagination is amazing, and you just want to be real. For this, I mean, because I was in fine art doing narratives for a while, or trying my hand at it, which You know, I like them, and they're tough to do. I mean, like Howard Terpene or Z.S. Lang or Mian Sittu or some of these painters, contemporary painters that paint Western subject matter. And Western is really still a very viable area to make a career out of. It's one of the few fine art areas that will carry a person's career as far as having collector base that's really strong. So for a lot of fine art painters, they sometimes do end up gravitating more into the Western genre just out of necessity more than anything, because if you want to make a living at it, it's a really good lucrative way to go. Okay, so in these high Sierra veins of, and I'm not a geologist by any means, but the rock formations will have veins of different colored rock, and it could be, a lot of them are gray and dingy. This is a very overcast day. I have to ask myself at this point, do I want to create a fictitious illusion of light somewhere in the scene, meaning maybe create raking light coming through that does not exist in my reference, and that would be an invention job. But for those of you who are conceptors, visual development guys, you know that that's kind of the way it goes. A lot of times you're making up scenarios because you either have no reference or the reference you have is inadequate. Maybe it has some decent shapes in it, but it doesn't have really what you're looking for as far as the exact lighting scenario. So either still a lighting scenario from some other image that you've seen, or you borrow it from your brain, from mental imagery that you've seen while you were traveling or hiking. All these are possibilities. All these are things that I use on a regular basis. So when I'm out traveling, I'm not just sitting around hiking going, yeah, it's a beautiful day, whatever. I'm thinking about these situations and how they resonate with me so that I can remember them for future use in paintings. And when I'm on my painting, a lot of times my recollection is more of a feeling, a recollection of a mood or something that I remember being there. And when I capture that mood in my painting and it reminds me of that same feeling, if I'm in tune with my feelings from more of an intuitive standpoint, then I'm able to know that I'm doing something believable that I've seen before that reminds me. And for invention, guys that do invention all the time, man, it's absolutely essential that you develop and cultivate that ability to recall very subtle color harmonies in times of the year, times of the day. You know, that nice orange light that you get on certain times of the year when it permeates through and creates this incredible warmth. How does that affect the greens? How does it affect everything when that in that lighting scenario? And try to recall that. Try to remember that. So if you're out and about and you see an interesting phenomena, lighting phenomena or whatever, just stop and take it in. Try to remember it. You don't need to do a quick painting. Yeah, that'd be ideal or something, but a lot of times you're not going to have your paints with you or anything, but think about how many times you've just been driving down the street or down the road and, you know, stuck in traffic or something. There's this beautiful lighting scenario happening all around you. You might as well pull off the road and sit and just observe it. Take some mental notes so that when you're trying to capture that in one of your own paintings down the road, you have a better idea of what that recall of that moment looked like. So you can always be learning how to paint if you are disciplined in how you see, how you think. You don't always have to be putting pencil to paper or paint to canvas. Sometimes it's just a matter of being very observant. Now, there's some rock coming through the water. Here's this cascading, beautiful S-curve. So we have this nice S-curve composition where we're leading ourselves in and out of the trees, down through the valley, down around, the water comes around, then it sweeps through, and then it comes down into the bottom. And so we have a beautiful S-curve composition, and the S-curve leads us right up to our center of interest, which is these three guys right here. And out of these three guys on horseback, the guy in the front is the main guy. Best stance, most dynamic, most information. Secondary would be the guy to the right, and third, the one in the back. And for compositional sake, an uneven amount of people is better than having two guys. So three is better than two. Five is better than, four. So even numbers, you can use them, and you'll find successful paintings that have been done that way. But uneven numbers are usually a little bit better. And so anyway, all this stuff is kind of things I'm thinking about. When I was doing my due diligence for this painting, I'd be thinking of Howard Terpene. I'd be thinking of some of the great storytellers, narrative storytellers that have worked in this genre. And I would be thinking about cross-referencing books on them, looking at their compositions, trying to borrow some of their mojo, some of their understanding to get into this painting. So anyway, this is just a nice little preview. Now this is illustration, this is fine art, this is concepting. This is everything wrapped into one. I'm using skill sets from all those different disciplines, all those different careers I've worked in, all those different areas over the years. I'll be drawing from in this particular piece. So there is no wasted time, no wasted studying. Everything comes back. Everything is useful at some point. So, you know, when you're doing those jobs where you think, oh God, this is such a drag and this and that, there's no wasted. You'll get something out of it. You'll use it for something down the road. Sometimes it's just, I'm glad I did that. I never want to do that ever again. And that's what I learned from that, is that I don't want to, that's not, does not bring me joy. I'm going to move in this other direction. So that can be a very awesome observation as well. Any questions coming in or anything? You guys?
No.
Boy, everybody's quiet out there. What's going on with you guys? Hopefully everybody's been doing good. Those of you who are checking in that do take the online school, you know, again, if you want to ask some questions, we can try to keep it more, maybe more geared towards what we're doing here, but you know, fire off some questions if you have them. So what I have here is you could do your stains ridiculously anal, and you could work really up to the finished masses in a very controlled manner, and you could spend a lot of time on massaging and building these stains. I'm going to build just generic ones, and then once I feel like I've got a good feel for it, I'm just going to go right in and start being a little bit more aggressive. Number one, I have 3 hours, and I want to try to get as much done as possible. So we have these shelves, and as the shelves turn away from the light source, they get dark. But in the photo, which I know is a lie, the darks don't really appeal to me. They're dead, they're dank, they don't really have a lot of color associated with them. So I'm going to go ahead and use my own creative license, my freedom, creative freedom, and I'm going to put in and assign a color to those darks. So I put some red in the dark, so it became like a dark burgundy. Now I've added some black back to the mixture now. And so yes, it's kind of a neutral. It's still slightly diluted, a little bit more so than the upper layer of paint that I'll be putting in, but it's not totally opaque. We're not really tiling like we do in the portraiture. If you guys have been through the online school and you've taken the portrait phases, you know that portrait is where we teach people how to tile. Tiling, shape recognition painting. There is a lot of shape recognition happening in this painting, but it's not as generically, like I'm not trying to turn every form with a juxtaposition of temperature, shape, and value, and you know, all that. I'm just simply, so landscape, when we teach it at the atelier or when I do it, it's a little bit more unorthodox style of gouache painting. A lot of dry brushing, a lot of watercolor techniques. So it's a little bit, it's not the best place, in my opinion, to teach people the value of turning form with temperature, which later really improves your oil painting, because oil, it has a tendency to be so slimy and gooey and wet that it moves around on the people a lot that are using it. And if you're not really comfortable with that, then you might end up with really ugly color harmonies and lots of grays that you weren't intending. Grays are good, but there's good grays and there's bad grays. And usually it has to do with the harmony of the grays as it relates to other parts of the painting. So you just want to make sure that when you're doing this stuff, that you're keeping your mind on straight, your head on straight, and you're thinking logically about everything. And I know a lot of you're at different stages of development, so you know, you can't cross-reference things that you don't know, right? So it's kind of like that old saying again, that it's hard to indicate what you don't know. It's almost impossible to indicate what you don't know. So from that standpoint, I tell people a lot of times that you just want to learn as much as you can. You don't know when you're going to need to use it. You don't know when that information is going to be pertinent. A lot of times you'll be going through some class or learning some technique thinking, you know, I don't know, maybe my time would be better spent. And, you know, maybe it would. But at the same time, maybe there's this, you know, you don't know really what you're going to be doing professionally yet. You might think you know, but, you know, it may very well end up different than you thought. So in this stage of the painting, I'm going to go in and it's not going to be, that's why I talk a lot, because it's not the funnest to watch. You know, I'm sitting here thinking, God, you know, people watching this are going to want to yawn. But it's basically putting in my darks. And you can only do that so fast. I mean, it's just the way it is. You can't, you know, do it faster than you can. So I try to rush a bit when I do demos, because I like to keep my viewers engaged. And it's a fine art, and it's an art that I've had, you know, 25 years to figure out. So I feel like I have a good bead on, you know, how much people can tolerate quiet before they just lose their attention and go somewhere else. Or whether, you know, so I'm always trying to be really engaging, you know, and so the conversation will go all over the place when you're studying with me or listening to me. Sometimes it's just me thinking of things, and then I'll blurt them out, and hopefully they're pertinent, and I'll try to keep them obviously more geared towards what's going on. I'm not going to go off into totally left field, but okay. So I'm laying in again with this is an angle brush. You can see it's got a slight angle on it. It's just kind of handy for chiseling in and out of shapes, and because I'm doing these kind of rock faces that kind of have kind of they turn as I drop it. They turn the corner really fast. I mean, they're turning really sharp. So having a brush like that can be kind of nice, just convenient. Okay, so there's a lot of dark down in here, and in those darks, there's darker darks. Again, the photo went flat black, so I know that in this corridor down here, which is a shelf, there's got to be deeper information that I can't see from the reference I'm using. So, with a little bit of logic and a little bit of shape design, I can invent that and inject it in there. Nobody could ever call me on it. It'd be impossible. So, I already know that. So, I just need to make it look cool. I need to make it look nice. So, sometimes, that's where you're at in a painting. You just say, okay, well, and then you ask yourself, okay, you're not trying to fool people. You're really not trying to lie to them. You're just trying to, you know, you're working in an adverse situation. Information cannot be seen. So therefore, you have options. Copy what you see, even though it doesn't look very good, which means it's not going to look very good on your painting, right? Why would it? So you have a choice, and the choice for me is to invent, to make it look good, regardless of what the photo is telling me. So again, most painting for me is part what I see, part what I know, and part what I wish I saw. And that last part is where the magic is. The last part is where your individuality is. The last part is what will give your paintings their look. What you wish you saw is your opinion about what you want to say. And you need to have strong opinions. Doesn't mean you have to be a jerk about it, because I know a lot of people that don't understand the difference between that. Strong opinions that are well backed up by logic and knowledge are really confident decisions. And they're not arrogant, and they shouldn't come off as such. Because they're coming from a place of honesty and authenticity that should resonate with yourself and other people. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. And I think that's absolutely what we need to channel. Because no one's going to pay you for mediocre efforts. No one's going to do that stuff. So if you're looking to become a professional, we have to have confidence in our decision making and stand by it. Otherwise, what do we have? We don't have much. So we really need to cultivate that. But as you cultivate that, again, do that with respect to the fact that, you know, it's a small world out there. There's a lot of good people. All the good people know all the other good people. And so you want to be very conscientious with how you present yourself as a professional. And I can't tell you enough about that, because, you know, I do see a lot of young guys coming up that are really, really good, almost too good, but their attitudes are really bad. They're very arrogant. They're very cocky. And it's very unbecoming. It just shows their age. And they're not bad guys. They just need to know that there's a pecking order. And you get in the pecking order, and you have respect for the people that came before you, after, you know, people that are coming up. I always try to look at myself in where am I in the big picture of my development as a painter, how long I've been doing it, what's my background. And I always try to put my best foot forward to be kind of an ambassador for the traditional arts, you know, especially since I own an atelier and I've taught for so long. People have preconceived ideas or hear things about me, about my personality, about how I am. Some of it's true, some of it's not. Some of it, I don't know where it came from, but that's why me doing things like this, this is me, this is how I am, this is how I will present myself, and hopefully you guys can make your own decisions, ultimately. But the goal is always to present information. It's not my way or the highway, it's simply, these are some good things I've learned. Have some fun with them, see if they can help you out a little bit. And if they do, then I'm really happy that I could help with that. I jump around a lot too, you notice. You know, I'll be down here in this corner, then I'll jump up here, then I'll be over here, and then I'll be over there. I want to bring this whole piece up as a whole. I don't want to get tunnel vision in one area yet. It's way too early for that.
Hey, Jeff, we have a question from Rachel Anderson.
Okay.
She says, for someone new to gouache painting and narrative landscape painting, what dimensions do you recommend working in to start with? Should I do lots of small, quick pieces or slow, big studies?
Really good question. I would say a little of both, but I would, you know, gouache is a very manageable medium for small works. And so it's fun to work in quickly. It's great for, even for plein air sketching, outdoor sketching. I would do both. I would do studies from other master painters. Pick a favorite, Edgar Payne, Levitan, someone like that. Like, just some really great landscape painter that you're inspired by. It could be Schmid. And do little 9x12s, 8x10s, you know, whatever is proportional to the one that, you know, maybe something that's in the ballpark of the proportion of the piece that you're emulating. Also, just photo reference that you've taken of your own. Doing these, this is it's pretty big. This is good size gouache. It's not huge, but I can't remember what it is, 11 by 14 or something. But gouache doesn't really want to operate 24 by 36, 30 by 40. You can do it, it's just expensive and tedious. Because the medium has a hard time covering large areas. You just have to have a ton of paint out, and these tubes are tiny. So if you were trying to paint, and I've painted pretty large in it, it's just not for everybody. Can you do it? Yes. Is it advisable? Is it the sweet spot for the medium? No. It prefers to be painted smaller and more intimately. And so I see it as more of a more intimate medium sometimes than oil, from the standpoint that it wants to be painted in a very controlled way in a small scale is its sweet spot. Whereas in oil, you can, you know, obviously paint very large in. So I've got this shelf here. It's got kind of a burgundy inside with some darker aspects of burgundy, and then I've gone one layer, put a little bit more black with my mixture, and I'm hitting some of the, delineating deeper areas of undershelves, things that are tucking underneath, things that I could imagine tucking underneath. Some I can see, some I can't, but I can deduct from where what's going on around to the left and right of the rock that it must continue on into the deeper aspects. So I may be able to use, again, some logic to help solve the problem. Now, we're at my studio filming today, which is a little different. We usually film up at the school, which is not far from my studio. It's about 5 minutes. But we're right down by a train track, so occasionally you're going to hear the bane of my existence, which is that train. It's about 15 feet off my studio. And when we're filming for the online school, it has become unbelievably annoying, because every 10, 15, 20 minutes, the train comes through and I got to stop.
We're going to have outtakes of just that.
Oh, yeah. It's hilarious. I mean, some of the banter that occurs, and it's probably, yeah, it's very not PG-13 or anything. It's just really annoys me, but it's funny. It's always something.
Hey Jeff, you're running 27 minutes. How do you want to do breaks today?
Probably every, I'm fine with whatever, so we could do 30 minutes, okay. Maybe 40.
Okay.
If people are okay with that. Any questions out there, you guys?
Anything? We have another from Margaret O'Brien.
Margaret.
Jeff, is the direction of the stroke you were pulling important, and how do we decide which direction is best?
Oh, you guys are coming up. We got some very, savvy watchers today. That's good. Observers. Painting with and against the form is always something you got to think about. With gouache, it's not as prevalent because most of gouache dries flat, and you're not looking at the sexy kind of cool-looking brush strokes that oils give you. Oil paints, that's their sweet spot. Thick, juicy, sculptural. You can paint in it very thin, like a Bouguereau or Jerome or any of those other great artists. But to me, its sweet spot really, and its uniqueness, is its ability to cut and carve shape with sculptural integrity, like interesting looking shapes. So with oil, you have to be way more conscientious of with and against the form. In gouache, because everything's going to end up being kind of matte, you're not really sculpting the brush strokes and showing the claw marks of the actual bristles or something like that. So you'll be actually more apt to not have to worry as much about directional. Although, like if this shelf is going down, like it cuts and it drops off very dramatically, like it looks like, then my paint strokes more than likely will be put down in a vertical manner, emulating that. Whereas in a lot of this stuff, coming down these crease lines back in the hillside as it passes back into the distance, the creases, I'm kind of painting along the cut lines in the rock as well. So I am kind of painting with the form, but I'm not as worried about it as I would be in oil paint. So hopefully that helps answer that question a little bit. As this value goes back in the distance, obviously it's going to go darkest darks and lightest lights are going to be relegated to the foreground. As we move further back in a landscape, depending on the distances we're talking about, atmospheric perspective, depending on where we're painting, is going to start to rear its head. What is atmospheric perspective? It's the illusion of things passing away from us, and the atmosphere, the dust in the atmosphere, things of that sort will affect the values. And so what happens as you go into the distance is your values close closer and closer together. So there's not such an extreme jump between your lights and your darks. They actually close down, giving the illusion of distance. So we want to make sure that we don't have punchy, punchy dark darks way out in the distance, because they're going to pull that distant object into the foreground or middle ground if we don't watch out. So we have to be very conscientious of our value control as we stair-step back in a landscape, which is a little different, obviously, than we don't have to worry about that as much in a figurative piece or a portrait. We have to worry about it more when we get to, you know, there's foreshortening in the figure for sure, but we're talking inches versus miles. You know, outdoors, you've got miles and miles of real estate, and so things drop back very quickly and very obviously. In a figure, the distance relationship between the toe and the head, or the toe, the knee, and the hip is so small that the distortion is very subtle, which creates a more difficult foreshortening problem in figure in some ways. More subtle. Okay.
Jeff Razvan Petria asks, how smooth is the transition from acrylic to oil? Am I better off learning oil with tempera and gouache?
Yeah, I prefer it. I mean, I've worked a lot in acrylic over the years. I have to say it is probably my least favorite medium, right up there. And again, it's not anything other than, I know there's going to be some diehard acrylic people out there that are going to probably want to email me about that. But it's really just a personal thing. And for me, the plasticky feel of acrylic has never appealed to me. The actual feeling of the paint itself and the way it layers. I've seen some amazing stuff. One of my favorite painters, I would say just in general, but in the realm of Western or even animal, is Bob Kuhn. And Bob Kuhn is one of the best acrylic painters I've ever seen, as far as my taste. He's a little more painterly with it. He almost uses it to look like oil. And he's a good oil painter too, but he primarily chose to use acrylic. So for me, you know, I would say the only thing with acrylic that's a bummer when you're trying to learn better oil painting is that you can't reactivate it. And as a result, the tiling concept doesn't work very well in it, because you need to be able to reactivate the paint to be able to manipulate your edges. And watercolor will not allow you to do that. Tempera will not allow you to do that. No medium will allow you to do that except gouache, that I know of. Digital, but I mean, if we're talking about traditional mediums, that's the one I would go to. So now what I'm doing too is I'm still in the realm of darks, and I'll continue to answer your questions, but I'm kind of on a little bender here. I'm just going to keep moving through these masses, and I'm looking at who's in front of who. This rock is in front of that rock. That rock's in front of that rock. And so we've got all these cut lines and creases where slate and parts of rock have broken off over, you know, millennia, through, you know, everything from glacier runoff to glacier movement. So we have some pretty sharp-edged fragmentation of the rock from pretty abusive nature things happening throughout, you know, time. And so we want to try to capture those, and we want to try to get who's in front of who. So we have a tree over here, a little tree coming up here that I've made a little bit more robust, meaning a little bit larger, a little bit stronger than what's in the reference. And again, that's my interpretation. I look at it and say, well, that plant, does that tree look adequate for what I want to accomplish? Is it too interesting? Is it too big? Is it too chaotic? Is it too this? Is it too that? I need to have an opinion about that tree. Now, just because nature made that tree does not mean it's a perfect tree. There are some people that will argue that and say, well, I just copy nature because it's perfect. Well, there you go. I don't. I think it's open for debate, and it's open for pruning and also bonsaiing. You know, I'm going to go in there and chop, cut, chisel, add, detract to make shapes that are not too symmetrical, asymmetrical, or weight them differently visually so that they look better for my use. And so for me, all of nature is a springboard for a design problem that needs to be dealt with. And I'm more from that standpoint of, again, interpreting it based on what I would like to see, and then going for it and trying to design it accordingly. And that's, again, that's going to be up to you to determine how much of that you want to learn from me, how much of that you would want. I mean, again, not everything I say and do, obviously, is meant to be gospel. It's just stuff that I've learned. So, you know, and things that I use. But they may not resonate with some people, and that's great. I think that's, how could it possibly resonate with everybody? So you're going to have some tight painters out there that are going to be up in arms about something, and then you have loose painters that, you know, this and that. I think the key thing is just keep yourself in a position of pliable concepts, and in life in general, but in art, there's no room for absolutes, really. Like, this is the only way it works, and this is the best style ever painted. When people start throwing out those kind of fanatical concepts, I just don't listen, because I know it's a bunch of malarkey, really. So I just kind of go, yeah, great, whatever, that's your opinion, excellent. But don't take it so personally. Like, I'm not personally insulted if someone paints tight, because I'm a looser painter. I can hold my own painting tight if I wanted to, but I don't really want to. I have in the past. So it's just a matter of kind of learning to be receptive and open to lots of things. So again, I'm laying in these transition areas. There'll be a point at which the painting will really start to take shape. And I hope that'll be fun for you guys to watch. But this is a very important stage of every painting, and everyone's going to have to go through this. There is no getting past the monotonous grind of the land. It's just, you got to get your mindset right when you go into it, because it beats a lot of artists. You know, a lot of artists beat themselves by either rushing past the prep stage or the stain stage, getting into too dense of application of paint too early, which makes for a kind of not the best look. You want breathing room in your areas. And now in gouache, it's not going to be as pertinent as oil, but it's still, I still want areas that are thinner than other areas and areas that are thicker. It's not, again, it's not going to be as prevalent. You know, in oil, it definitely plays a huge part where you, you know, that old axiom of thin your darks and load your lights, meaning keep your dark areas a lot thinner so that there's some air pushed into them. And then you can pop and really, you know, sculpt those upper layers of thick sculptural strokes. So that's something to keep in mind. So in watercolor or in, oh, here comes our train, but in watercolor gouache, you're not going to be dealing with that as much. Now there's a lot of, in this slate, it's very wet. Not only is it a damp day, it's a gray day, but also there's a lot of spray and mist coming off of this stream, creating a very wet veil over the rock. So it affects the rock. The rock takes on some greens. It's got some darker, so black and a little bit of sap green, maybe a little bit of phthalo. But, you know, kind of, and again, these are these little, if we were doing this online, I would have, you know, I would be using a another camera to show you my palette, and the palette would appear to the lower left as I was painting, which is ideal. But again, these are intended more for just teasers for you guys to kind of see what we do versus them being, I can't shoot them the same way. So I apologize for you not being able to see my palette is what I'm getting at. But
I was thinking when we go to break, we could show them your palette just so they can see what it's looking
like. Yeah, I could pull it in or something so you can take a look. Where are we at as far as time?
Another 3 minutes before I hit 140 minutes.
Okay, so yeah, we're going to want to take a little break here in a minute. Moving pretty good, but man, this may take two Friday night sessions. We might have to finish this one on a second. We'll see how it goes. You know, I'm fast, but I don't know if I'm going to be that fast be able to do that. But let's, okay, so I'm putting in, again, a little darker green. So you can see as I'm inching up, my stains are becoming darker. They're becoming closer to the stains that are actually in the photo. In the beginning, I'm not looking at laying my stains down exactly the same value as what I'm seeing in my reference, because it's too early for that. I have to think underneath the finish, and I got to work my way up to the finish. In order to do that, I have to think a little more abstractly about what I'm doing. So again, kind of coming in, staining some of that green in, which is going to work really nice next to the ruddy reds. So again, complements, red and greens are complements. A dingy green and a dingy red are still complements. Now you get into tertiary relationships and other things. I am not a color theory guy. You guys all know that. I'm just not a huge fan of really overthinking the color aspect of things and making it too scientific. There are people out there that are really good at that, so you may want to, you know, check some of them out. Also on our, you know, Meadow's going to be doing color theory online. She's awesome, great colorist. And some of the other, I think we'll have a couple color theory classes for you, but just enough to get you to be dangerous. I think a lot of good color and great color is through experimentation, watching other good artists that are good at color manipulate it, and being willing to manipulate your color and not be, you know, confined to too much theory. And again, there's going to be some theory guys out there that are going to be biting your teeth, you know, tongue right now, wanting to argue with me about that point. That's fine. If your color's working for you, you're an awesome colorist, and you learn it through theory, then God bless you. Just not me. You know, it wasn't my way of wanting to learn it. So, each to each their own. So I'm going in and knocking back some of these little areas that are, again, relegated to the shelf. You know, they're darks within there, but not as dark as the dark dark. So I'm kind of got some layering happening in the shadows as well. The water down here in the foreground. So a lot of times, now this is a non sequitur. I was about to say something about the water in the foreground, but before I say that, I'd like to preface how I normally, if this was a large painting, I would establish part of my foreground, part of my middle ground, and part of my furthest back objects in value, so that I could then, as I work my way through those, the foreground, middle ground, background, I could jump very sequentially through those points using those, triangulating off of those values in order to judge values that are in between those two those areas so that they don't get out of sequence. So hopefully that doesn't confuse you too much. That's just one way of working up a large complex painting logically, and we'll get into that in studio landscape online. Demoing that is doing a very large painting from a small study and how we go about doing that, because it definitely is an art in and of itself. Okay, so pretty soon my foreground guys on horseback are going to want to be dealt with here very soon.
You're at 42.
Okay, so we're going to take a little break right now. Again, keep asking questions if you have them. I'll pull my palette up here so you can take a look at it, and then I'll be back in about 5 minutes to continue laying in. I'll lay in some of the guys next, which will be kind of fun to watch. Anyway, okay, thanks for joining. I'll be back in a minute. So let's see. Let me just
put it on top. That's fine.
Oh, it's going to... Could get sloppy. Hey, Jeff.
I'll just scroll down on that and zoom in. We'll just reset it when we start again.
Cool. You want to run up and...
Yeah, after we start again, I'll go run over.
Okay, cool. 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 That's good. So you got the message, the note?
I did. I was actually on foot.
You were on foot?
For the one time.
Oh, God. She dropped you off and then you just...
No, I walked from my mom's place, but she got me here. She was running me here, and she just finished up, so.
That's cool. No worries.
It's not Tom. It's good to be back. The real Tom. The real Tom.
Actually, looks pretty good. It's good to see you. That looks pretty bad, yeah.
So how long have you been down here now? Are you here, like, for good?
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome, dude. Awesome. Oh, yes. This is the place to be.
It's good to hear.
You got two people coming back to good now.
Okay. Okay.
You and me both.
Yeah,
it's good start.
That's what to do, man.
So, when did you get in? Last week we drove in. We drove into San Diego last Tuesday.
Okay.
So, like a week ago. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, almost exactly a week ago.
Nice.
It's good.
We're good. Where were you?
Where are you?
Wisconsin.
Oh, Wisconsin.
I'm probably doing this back before it drips all the way.
Yeah, yeah. I was in the town of 1,200 people.
Wow. Yeah.
Out in the mountains. That's it. 1,200 people. There's a lot of denim, sleeveless denim.
A lot
of being chopped.
Yeah.
Funny. That's great. It's interesting.
I always forget that at break time, it's still...
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's neat, though. I'm really happy to be able to do this. I mean, that's cool that everyone from Europe is going to be able to do this.
Yeah, I think they're like,
wow. Yeah, that's nice.
That's great, man.
Yeah, it's cool.
It's awesome. It's a lot of fun.
All right.
We'll do another one.
We'll do another one. It's a new place. It doesn't have, like I said, a studio section for me, so I
can Yeah, maybe I'll talk to those guys tonight and see if I can maybe get Lucas to do something. Or
World's Collide.
You always do like a dragon head, like a little dragon demo.
Yeah.
And then I think maybe get back to doing some drawing. You can potentially do like portrait.
We could ask that.
Yeah. Traffic from not as much traffic from me.
He's doing good. It's a couple times I've walked out.
I can start one.
I just have my digital station.
I mean, I'd rather just see as much done as I can.
Just keep going.
Okay, everybody, I'm going to get back a little early because I just can't wait to get back on this. No, I'm serious about that. I kind of just want to work through a little bit. So Take breaks when you need to. It's all good. Just if you want to take a little break, just, you know, I won't know. So, okay, so the Indians I have in here are screen grabs I took off of an old movie, an old obscure movie. And then I changed some of the, around a little bit, some of the information on them. And so by the time I'm done with them, no one will ever know where I got them or any of that stuff. So very much like concepting. As an illustrator, ex-illustrator, ex-conceptor, I'm very used to doing that kind of stuff. And you always know that. You can always tell illustrators. Usually they're very tenacious artists. They have to be. And in some ways, I think they're even stronger in training than fine artists, because they have to do so much manipulation and invention and stuff that you have to retain more information to be able to do that. And in order to do that, you have to train harder, longer, in order to memorize all that information. So for me, I'm spotting the darks. It's a terrible piece of reference as far as accuracy. So there'll be a fair amount of invention that I have to do within the confines of the actual, you know, structure of his head, but they're tiny. I mean, they're tiny figures. So I don't want to, you know, make them into an Amatadema or something, you know, and get in there and render it to the nth degree. But I will want to make them, you know, decent looking. So we'll get there. They're really, I love painting little heads and stuff in gouache because it's such an easy medium to render in. If you try doing this, a guy this size in oil, it's just like pulling teeth. I mean, it's going to be really brutal. So I might just kind of putting the darks in. So the guy's got like black hair, obviously. Most Indians are going to have black hair, dark hair. So I'm going in and kind of hitting that. And I'm looking at the horse, and there's some war paint on the horse and around the eyes and down the front of the nose. So I'm not worried too much about that yet. So there's like this kind of like lime green circle around the eye that I'll get to in a minute. We have the ear, one ear here, and then on the other side, a little indication of the ear. I'll outline the actual face a little bit just to get it to pop so I can see what I'm doing. There's a hand mark on the side of the front of the chest of the horse. Again, just this particular Indian's markings for his horse. Again, I don't know all the logistics behind that. Again, if you were gonna get into Western art, you kind of have to get into researching a lot of that. And so it's not for everybody when you do historical narrative pieces, but it's a very fascinating area to work in, and it would be no different if you were doing, I don't know, maritime pieces or my dad used to do a lot of aviation art and stuff for the Smithsonian, things like that, where, you know, all the planes have to be researched, all the rivets, all the everything on it has to be authentic and you know, up to scrutiny from people that either flew them or knew about them. So when you get into certain genres, you know, the bar is raised for research, and some of them are heavy due diligence research areas, and you want to make sure that you're capable and interested in doing that before you jump into doing these kind of things. And trust me, because I've kind of, you know, beat around doing them and then decided I don't know if that's really me, and I don't really know if I want to be spending that much time, and am I really sincerely, authentically interested in this subject, or am I doing it mostly because it's monetarily, you know, it's a good monetary thing, I can make money at it or something, you know. We all have to compromise a little bit. We all have to kind of think about what we're willing to do versus what we would like to do versus what we ideally would like to do. I mean, these are all different areas that we all have to go through doing stuff we don't want to, and I've done my fair share, so I'm always thinking pragmatically about that stuff. But even when I did stuff that I wasn't that into, I still gave it my all, and I still found ways to trick myself into being enthusiastic about it. Because you have to. You can't go into a job with a really bad attitude. It'll show in your work immediately. And so you always have to put your best foot forward. And that's how you get out of one situation and into another, I think, is just by, you know, once you've learned the lesson from that particular area, you kind of naturally passes away and gives way to other circumstances. So, you know, to sit and grovel about it and complain about it and stuff just seems like it's the universe's way of, you'll just continue to be in that situation as long as you're doing that. The minute you learn what you had to from it, you kind of move on and you move into a different area. So I think always have a good attitude if you're working in an area of gaming or something and you're not that hot on it because it's kind of boring for you now and you want to be a conceptor, bite your time, go back, start training, get better skills. But don't complain about the situation you're in. Just make the best of it. There's always so much to be had from all these different, you know, different things that you're going to be doing, obviously, throughout your career. If you're a younger artist, you just don't, maybe you don't have the experience base yet to know that you're going to probably have 5-6 careers in art, maybe even more now. So you just want to be well prepared technically so that you can move in and out of different genres, different, you might be a video game concept or a movie guy that goes into movies. Later you exhaust the movie thing and then go into freelance illustration, for a number of years, maybe even a decade or two. And then you come out of that and go into fine art. So you might have 3 or 4 full blown careers in the course of your life. And I think that's what you have to prepare yourself for nowadays, you know? So in order to do that, you just got to be better trained, more, you know, have more skill sets, you know, be good at landscape, be good at still life, be good at portrait, be good at invention, be good at all these things. But you have to do that in stages. You know, we all have to work our way slowly up to proficiency in all these different areas. There's so many areas to study. You don't want to be careless with how you prepare for these different rigors of these, because each one is an art in and of itself. You know, landscape's its own art, and you know, narratives is the art of landscape mixed with the art of figure, mixed with storytelling and all kinds of other stuff. So we have all these interesting areas to work in. If you're coming up, I just say try to be honest with yourself. What really moves you? Is it fantasy? Is it historical? Is it none of those? You know, you don't have to be a great conceptor to be a great artist. You don't have to, you know, I mean, there's so many options out there. Okay, so again, I'm kind of harping on a lot of that stuff that maybe even isn't of interest to you guys, so I don't want to get too far off of that. Now, all the leather that he's wearing is suede and different animal hides and stuff, and it has different, you know, some of it's a little oranger, some of it's a little bit more yellow ochre, some of it's a little more taupey. So I'll just kind of randomly mix it up a little bit, looking at my reference, and kind of go through and hit, again, some of this is somewhat opaque, mixed with somewhat areas that are somewhat diluted. So again, I'm kind of working little areas of stain next to little areas of opaqueness. And again, there's no fast and easy rule for that, so I don't have a formula for you. You'll just have to play around with it until you get good at it yourself. I know a lot of people don't want to hear that, but some things, that's just the way it goes. You know, there's no easy, fast answer. Any questions over there, anybody?
We have a question from the Bananas of Death.
Wow, that's quite excellent.
How much money does a decent fine art fella get?
Depends. I mean, you know, I know guys that make millions of dollars a year, and I know guys that make hundreds of thousands of dollars a year, and I know guys that make thousands of dollars a year. So, and it's not always who's better, you know? Sometimes it's positioning, sometimes it's galleries, sometimes it's style, sometimes it's, it really depends. You know, I like I said, I have friends that are way up there. I mean, hundreds of thousands of dollars a painting. You know, Morgan Wessling, Jeremy Lipkin, Me and Situ. I mean, these are pretty hefty, pretty hefty prices. My work's pretty far up there, which is cool. But you know, I didn't start that way. I started out really humbly, you know, $1,500 a painting, $1,000 a painting, a couple $1,000 a painting. And over time, as my craft and my skill got better and better, and my reputation, I won awards, I got into shows, I got into organizations, I worked my way up to master signature status over years of competing and putting pieces in shows consistently, and then getting juried into, or having to submit your work for jurying into these upper echelons of these organizations. These are all things that help to build your reputation, build your name. That translates to higher prices. That translates to people, more value for your work. You can't just come onto the scene and say, I want $100,000 a penny. People, you're crazy. I remember when I first started in fine art, I came in, I was working really tight, very different than I do now, in oil, more like Clark Killings or someone like that. And many of you may not, he's a guy that passed away a couple years ago, but he was a fine art painter. But he was up in the hundreds of thousands of dollars for his paintings. But he would travel around the world and he'd paint, you know, areas that he traveled to. And he had this really tight style and it was really romantic and cool. And I dug it. I thought he was one of my favorite painters. He still is. I don't paint like that anymore. But when I started, I was painting like that. And I was in my mid-20s and I was making, my prices were way higher in some ways then than they are now, which is kind of sad in some ways, but also just I painted a very much more complicated, difficult style, and I thought because of that the prices should be higher. And that was, you know, common sense would say, yeah, that's probably logical. But then when I went to go into a really well-educated area of collecting where the collectors knew, they were very well-educated collectors, they knew the value of things, they knew who was getting what prices, they knew what awards they had won, what accolades they had gotten, how long they'd been doing it, those prices wouldn't really hold water. People would look at it and go, why should I pay that much for this guy when the guy next to him has won the Prix de West and he's been in all these other things and he's got all these accolades and he's cheaper than that guy? So from a logical standpoint, it wasn't figuring out correctly. And so, yeah, you might be able to charge exorbitant prices for your work and get a few people to buy it. But ultimately, if you want longevity in your career, you have to think of it from a standpoint of do my prices need to be in order to sustain a long-term career in fine art. And a lot of people just don't get that. Like if you come over into fine art from illustration and say you're one of the biggest illustrators in comic art, and now you want to paint fine art, and you want to charge a bunch of money for it, they don't see that as a positive. They see it as a negative. So they're not going to look at that and say, oh, yeah, you're the best movie poster painter in the world, and you get hundreds of thousands of dollars for a movie poster, and now you want $100,000 for the same technique painted in fine art. That's not going to wash. People aren't going to do it. They're going to say, you're off your rocker. There's no way. So sometimes the dues you pay in one career don't always translate to another career, unfortunately. So you might pay all these dues in illustration and think that you're going to just have this walk in the park over into fine art, and it's a humbling experience when you realize you got to pay your dues all over again in that industry. So you know, some dues translate and do go over to other careers. For example, if you were a high end conceptor and then you wanted to go over and become, say, you're an independent contractor. Or just a freelancer that does concepting and illustration work, like some of the guys like Lucas and Eric and guys that are at our school that you're starting to know about. They make really good careers. If they went over and wanted to work at DreamWorks or Disney as a conceptor, the work they've done over the years in all these different areas of freelance card games, World of Warcraft, all these different things, Magic the Gathering, they would translate over really well to a career that is in the entertainment industry that is concepting now for movies or something or something like that, or an in-house position, again, at DreamWorks or Disney as a conceptor. They would look at all those pieces and they would see the imagination capability, the invention capability, the execution capability, and that would very easily translate over. But if they were to go into fine art and now they want to do high-end portraiture or narrative cowboy work, that fantasy work is not going to pay dividends. They're not really going to care about that. So it really just depends. So I hope that answered your question. It was all over the place. But pricing is very difficult. A lot of people price by square foot inches. Like they have a per like square inch cost for their paintings. I think it's a little ridiculous. But that a lot of times people ask, what is your square inch? Like, so on someone like Terpene, it would be you'd have to take like a 40 by 50 that costs $800,000 and divide that out, and it's going to be a pretty hefty amount for his square, the size of his paintings. So anyway, there's all kinds of different ways to price. There is no set standard, which makes it really difficult for artists to know how to price their work. So yeah, you can make really good money, but you have to pay your dues. You got to get it in the pecking order, and you've got to respect the people that have come before you that have built up prices and what they've done to build up those prices. So you have to probably do something similar, I would imagine. In order to get your prices up to that area or that range. So it's an investment. It's always an investment of time and energy, and it should be. It shouldn't be any other way that I can see. So it's all good. Okay. Any questions over there?
Coming in? I think we're good since that one.
Okay. So again, we got like kind of a pelt hanging down the side here. It has a little bit more blue grays in it and stuff. It's probably more like a wolf. Looks like a wolf skin or something, and then you've got other ones that he's wearing that are more orangey, and they're probably like more off of a buffalo or something, something else, So again, you just have different values and different colors that are coming down the side of this character here, and there's a lot of stuff hanging off of his, the side of the horse that I have no idea what it is. It's medicine bag. It's any number of things. I have no clue. But it's just paraphernalia. It's just stuff that I need to indicate. So I'm not going to take inventory of it. I'm going to indicate noise and make the illusion of it looking like something complex is happening there. Okay. Which is what we call indication. Indication is the illusion of reality. It's not reality, it's the illusion of reality. And that can sometimes be more powerful than reality. So there's a lot of great concept painters, Berkey and people like that, that their whole career was based on indication. It really was all about the illusion of reality. There was no, it was all smoke and mirrors.
A Mr. Pavel Sokov would like to know, so does an illustration career harm the potential fine art career, or just not help it? As in, would we be destroying our fine art career potential by first going into illustration?
No, not at all. Morgan Wessling was first a movie poster conceptor like I was. I went through a huge phase of illustration, did heavy metal covers, did work for DreamWorks, Disney, got offered visual development with DreamWorks. I mean, I was all over the place in illustration for years when I was younger. And it's a great fertile training ground for fine art because of the discipline involved in negotiating with clients and getting work done under on command and under tough some of the toughest deadlines you'll ever have to do are in the entertainment industry. So I would say, no, it won't hurt you. But like I mentioned, it's not necessarily going to, what's going to help you with doing illustration is the discipline that you get from doing it. You know, that's the real payoff. The ability, again, to learn how to negotiate with clients, learn how to hit a deadline. Because, you know, in fine art, they might say, okay, we're going to give you a one-man show. We like your work. But next August, I need 45 pieces. Good luck. You know, we'll see you in that time, and you better have 45 pieces. You know, so no one's going to check in on you. No one's going to make sure you're doing your work. No one's going to call you every day to make sure that you're painting. They don't care. Just at that time, when that deadline comes, you're going to have deadlines for catalog work. You're going to have deadlines for all this stuff. You just need to hit all those deadlines, and you have to be incredibly disciplined in order to do that. And if you're not, you're going to be in trouble. If you're an ex-illustrator and you're used to hitting deadlines and used to grinding long hours, you're going to be way better off than some prima donna fine art guy that, you know, is real soft and can't hit deadlines like that, you know? So it will help from, in that standpoint, I think it's one of the best, most fertile training grounds for fine artists is illustration. And most great, my favorite contemporary fine art painters were ex-illustrators, a great deal of them. So I'm a huge fan of illustration. I've trained a lot of illustrators. I used to be, thank you, I used to be, you know, an illustrator. I never shy away from telling people that. I'm very proud of it. My dad's an illustrator. I never am embarrassed to say I was an illustrator. I'm actually very proud of the fact because I feel like they're some of the strongest fine art painters. So yeah, it's not going to necessarily translate over immediately, but your discipline and all the other things, your negotiation skills and all that will pay off really well in when you do go over into fine art, if you do. There's probably going to be some subtle cast shadows underneath these guys, but they're on this wet rock, so there might even be some, ultimately I might cast some shadows or some wet kind of looking, you know, reflection of them into the rock, but that'll be invented at a later time, so I'll get around to that when the time's right. In the meantime, I just got to create these shelves and stuff because I've actually placed these Indians into a scene that they were not in. So I have to make sure that the shelves that they're standing on look believable. The horse doesn't look like it's going to fall into the water or something goofy. I want some of the shadow patterns on the ground to morph into and melt into the actual hooves of the horse. You know, things like that so that I don't, let's see, so they don't look like they're floating there or something. Now, a lot of the horses are dark and they're silhouetted. If I was to do this with a larger painting, I might contemplate making one of the horses lighter or white. That's quite an invention job on the horse. You got to know the anatomy really well because you're going to be changing and pulling information out of the darks that don't exist and then having to create a light horse and the harmonies on that horse. But three dark horses, I don't know, not my favorite. I would like one of them to pop or push in front of the other by having it be more a light horse. So again, this horse I'm painting on right now, I would be thinking right now, is this a good time to maybe think about, you know, creating a lighter white type Mustang or something, you know, something that's a little bit punchier, but I don't want that horse to become the center of interest. So I have to ask myself that question too. Would it be better to make the lead horse white and the second horse dark? So these are all compositional questions. These are questions that are not easy to answer. They're not going to be ones that you can look up in some book somewhere and say, okay, what in this scenario, what would I make that horse? There is nobody that could tell you that other than, you know, you could run it by Terpnin and have him give you his 2 cents worth, and then run it by Schmidt and have him give you 2 cents worth, or myself, or anybody that was really decent at what they do, and they could give you an opinion. But ultimately, which opinion is 100% right? I mean, it's, yeah, there is none. It's just options. You know, options that, you know, might make a better painting statement, might not. The comps, these little paintings like this are where you want to figure that out. That's what they're for. They're it's a lot easier to figure out in this scale than it is in oil, and it's a lot cheaper. So it's definitely very smart to think about that stuff. These heads will be like little Frazetta heads. They're going to be like little, just really, these guys have war paint on. I mean, there's nothing, I mean, that's what's so fun about the idea of painting Indians, is they just had such incredibly cool design sense. The taupey colors, the way they wore their outfits, everything to me seemed really cool. I mean, like, just from an aesthetic standpoint, it was just really, really strong for what I like. You know, I love the way they wear like kind of the tattoo like war paint on the faces and stuff. It just, they look like Frazetta characters, you know, look like something just walked out of one of his pieces. But a great lineage, you know, of painters have painted cowboy art, you know, and I know a lot of people, oh yeah, it's Indians and cowboys, yeah, it's boring. Well, yeah, it's the only history we really have as a country. We don't have a lot. So it's kind of a neat area, and I toyed around with the idea of doing it, but like I said, over time I always kind of come back to, you know, other things that maybe are probably better for me, or just more of my interest. But I, you know, I like the idea of it, and I do paint some of it.
Hey Jeff, the Bananas of Death wants to know, what heavy metal covers did you do?
I only did a couple of them. One of them was, I'd have to think of the dates, they were a long time ago. One of them was this, this Harley Davidson with these bunch of these, like, kind of, I don't know, SS guys, you know, coming over the top of this hill, and there was a bunch of these gnomes and stuff hanging off of them, and there's a girl in the sidecar, and it's really, it was a cool, very Frazetta-ish. I'd have to show you, one of these times, on one of these, I'll pull out some of my old stuff, and I'll do a fantasy demo or something of some characters, just to show, you know, some of the range of where I come from. But there were two of them. There was that, and then there was one with a, because I was dabbling with doing hardcore comic stuff, and I had gotten some options from some guys at the time that were gonna, I was gonna have my own title, and I was gonna ink and pencil my own stuff, and that was for Cross Gen, which was a company that was kind of around for a while that was kind of similar to Image Comics in the 90s. And the guy wanted me to, you know, carry a title and do my own thing, and that was kind of a neat opportunity that I never ended up capitalizing on. But at the time, I was working under the name Zook, which was kind of a funny name that I had from a long ago. I'd have to tell you the story on how that name came about. It was kind of a funny name, but I was using that as my pin name for my illustration stuff. So I had two names, you know. I didn't do my illustration stuff under my own name, because at the time I was trying to get into fine art, and I didn't know whether it was going to hurt my career or not. And I wanted the freedom to be able to do my fantasy work without having to worry so much about it affecting my illustration or my fine art. So I worked under two different names, very similar to a writer that has a pen name. And some people think that that's stupid to do, and that, oh yeah, you know, but I didn't really care. You know, I was just, I did what I wanted to do. And at the time, writers do it all the time. They always work under aliases and pen names. So I said, why not, as a painter, just, you know, and again, if somebody wanted to look hard enough, they could find my stuff, but I just didn't want to broadcast it, you know, as a, you know, at the time, because I was in my mid-20s, you know, and I was unsure of where I was going and didn't know what the best course of action was and all that kind of good stuff that everybody has to think about when they're first building their name. So a lot of this stuff, you know, again, it's common sense, but it's also, you know, you, it's good to ask questions like that. It's good to find out from other people that have been through stuff. You know, hey, what was your experience? What did you go through when you first started? What have you seen out there? And again, my what I tell you is simply my experience. It could be, you could find it to be completely different than what I've found. And times are changing and things are different now than when I was coming up, but not that different. I mean, it's still about positioning, it's still about consistency, it's still about longevity and long-term focus. You know, there's so many immediate gratification. Everybody wants to go on Facebook and put their stuff out there and start making six figures and this and that without having paid any dues, it seems like. It's like, wow. I mean, they can try it, more power to them. When it doesn't work though, you know, they're gonna have to come up with a game plan that's plan B, which is usually just plain old-fashioned hard work and good planning, which will always beat out any, you know, flash in the pan, got lucky, you know, whatever. That, you know, you're always gonna find somebody out there that was able to somehow buck the system and make it work for them. But man, I wouldn't want to hang my hat on it. That's few and far between that can pull that off. And sometimes it's just a flashy style or something that maybe will be around for 10 years, maybe 5. But then sooner or later, if the skill set's not there and it's easy to duplicate, you'll have 50 guys painting just like you. And at that time, you're not that special and you're gonna be out of work. So you got to have skills that are hard to duplicate, skills that are hard to get. The harder the skills are to get, the more happy I am about it, because I'm more than willing to do the work, and most people aren't. So if you're willing to do the work and you're willing to seek out the proper information from the proper people and then take the time to get good at it, that's good enough, man. That's different enough. You will stand out, because most people want the quick fix, the quick this, the quick that. They just don't want to work 10 years at it. They don't want to train in anatomy properly. They're too lazy fundamentally. And not everybody, but you know, you run into that a lot, and then they kind of wonder why they're not that upper echelon, that top 5% that's out working at Blizzard or DreamWorks, or those ones are the ones that did the work, did the hard work, did the training, could have got it from places like ours, could have got it from somewhere else. Doesn't really matter. At the end of the day, you got to be good, whether you got it out of a Cracker Jack box or you got it out of Watts Atelier or you went to Art Center, you still got to be good. And that's the main thing to think about, is just skills. When in doubt, get better. So, you know, if things aren't working out for you, train harder, train more, train longer. Be patient. It'll work for you. It'll happen. You'll get what you put into it. So if you're putting in honest work and you're working hard, you will always have a payoff. I am 100% believe in that. But a lot of people, again, they're looking for ways to not train, to how can I get it cheaper, faster, quicker, easier? I want to be good without going to school. All these things. It's like, well, I mean, good luck. And I'm not saying that in a bad way. I'm just more power to you for trying to do it. But to me, it's just good old-fashioned hard work will pay off in spades for you. Okay.
Jeff, we have a question from Margaret O'Brien.
Hi, Margaret.
She would like to know, is it better when starting a career in fine art to concentrate on one genre, for example, still life, or to produce work in portraiture, landscape, and still life at the one time?
Good question. I like to be good at all of them, because most of the people I admire, whether it's, you know, most of the great painters, Fechin, Zorn, Schmidt, all of them could do all the different disciplines. They were good at landscape, they were good at still life, they were good at figure, they were good at multiple figures. So I think I made the mistake early on of putting out into the marketplace mostly work that I was trying to get good at, like landscapes. People didn't even know I could do figures, didn't even know I did portraits, and yet that's probably my strongest suit. So I had, at the time, I liked to challenge myself, and I was in galleries, but I was trying to learn, and I didn't want to get pigeonholed into being a painter of kids on the beach or something, you know. So I was all over the place, and I was young and you know, probably overzealous or whatever you want to call it, but yeah, I made the mistake of putting out my weakest stuff rather than my strongest stuff, and also jumping around too much, because I had the opportunity to do that because I had so many things going on that I wasn't reliant on fine art to make my living. It was more like playtime for me. So I was moving around a lot, trying things, which was healthy for me as an artist, but not great for my career as far as marketability. So I think when you go out there, depending on what stage of your life you're at, where you're at in your life, you know, if you're got many years ahead of you and you just want to cut your teeth out in the gallery scene, then you might want to Just, you know, pick a small gallery that's not one of those, you know, again, you probably wouldn't be able to get into a big one anyway, because you have to be pretty well known and your price point has to be pretty high before a big gallery will consider you. But get in a smaller gallery and just start putting your best work out there that you feel proud of. Could be a mixture of portrait. If you want to also be a well-rounded artist that people respect, all kinds of different things that you paint, then you may want to slip in every once in a while a still life or a landscape, but just make sure that they're all at the same caliber. Your landscapes can't look substantially different or worse than your portraits. And that's the big problem a lot of people run into. Like, I see a lot of guys out there right now that are incredible landscape painters, big name landscape painters, but they can't paint figures and they aren't good at portraits. And so they're stuck painting landscape whether they want to or not, because if they go to put out work that's of an inferior level and they're at that upper echelon level in another area, it's going to hurt their overall reputation, or it could. So they're almost kind of painted into a corner. They can't really take the time to learn figure. Their figures have to be as good or better than their landscape because people are expecting so much out of them. So if you come in with a real rocky landscape and you're a phenomenal portrait painter, it shows chinks in your armor. It makes you look, don't know what you're doing in certain areas, which is never good from a marketability standpoint. So, but you don't want to be so afraid to try things that you don't, so a lot of guys will go into like, you know, or artists will kind of study behind the scenes. And that's where this online program like that we're offering affords a great opportunity for those kind of people, because they're not going to stop and come back and study with me in my atelier, because they have too big of egos. You know, they're already too big named. They can't come in and I don't think they could, but would they come in and struggle through a class where there's an 18-year-old next to them that draws 50 times better than them when they're already a huge name as a landscape painter and make tons of money? Probably not. It's going to be too hard for their ego to handle. And I know that's not the right, that's a really weak excuse for that person. And it's kind of sad. But I you know, I see that a lot. And so, you know, if you can study it in anonymity behind the scenes, like all this information, and then be able to introduce those paintings at the proper time at a high level that's not detrimental to the other work, I think that's not a bad way to go. But that being said, I think for your own longevity and your own enjoyment, I would try to be as fluent and as good at as many mediums and concepts and try to bring them all together, just like a painting. Try to bring up the landscape, the still life, the portrait, the figure, and try to just layer them all together. But it does take a lot of time, a lot of discipline, and many, many more years of training than a normal person would go through to do that. Now, for these trees, I mean, again, I can smash my brush and just do a Bob Ross, right? And again, Bob Ross, as goofy as he was, and I like him, I have no problem with him, I think he's classic. It's just technique. I mean, everything's technique. It, you know, his happened to be, you know, combined with some funny little, you know, an interesting afro with some funny jokes, you know? And so he is a character, you know? But, you know, the way he applied paint wasn't that different than fetching, you know? It just, you know, there was a combination of straights and curves and layering that made fetching stuff, in my opinion, a stronger statement, obviously. So I know somebody's going to take this out of context and say that I think that Bob Ross is as good as Nikolai Fishen. No, but technique is technique. Whether you put it on with your nose or you put it on with your foot or you put it on with the side of a brush or whatever, it's still technique. And you can't get away from it. So whether I do that by smashing it or I sit and try to paint every little piece of that, I just want the effect. You know, the effect is what I'm after. And whatever way, especially for a comp, whatever effect's going to get me that as quickly and efficiently as possible, that's what I'm going to do. Okay, now I'm burning up time and I'm kind of jibber-jabbering a lot, not even thinking about what I'm, well, I'm thinking about what I'm doing, but my God, I'm all over, you know.
Jeff, we have a question, kind of a follow-up from what Margaret was saying by Pavel Sokov. Are all 45 pieces of a one-man show usually related to a single theme?
Not always. Some artists are really eclectic with what they put in their shows. Some people like to have a theme-driven show because they feel like that's maybe more, you know, they pick a subject and they're known for a certain genre. For a long time, I was painting gypsies and women that I liked the tapestries and the color combinations, the abstractions and stuff of that. So a lot of my, you know, but I would mix it up. I'd have some landscapes in there. I did a show years ago, one-man show for the Fechin Museum, which is Nikolai Fechin's house, but it's also a museum. And I was very fortunate to be afforded an opportunity to do a show there, a one-man show. And for that show, I didn't want to have it. I wanted it to be things that I love because there were no stipulations. It wasn't my gallery saying, hey, can you paint more of that because we can sell tons of it, you know, all that kind of goofy stuff that they want you to basically paint whatever they can sell the quickest and easiest. But that's not always what's fun for you to paint. So for me, I for that one, I put in nudes, I put in landscapes, I put in still lifes, I put in people that I wanted to paint, not people that I thought somebody would. I didn't care if I sold anything. I could care less. I just wanted to do a show that I was proud of, that I enjoyed. And so for that show, I opened up the floodgates and just said, I'm going to paint a show that I'm proud of. And it's going to have whatever interests me in it. And so if you can afford to do that, for what, you know, then do it. If for, you know, you got to put your kid through college and you got to, you know, pay the bills, then you might have to paint, you know, little cute girls on the beach or something. I don't know. Something that sells real easily. You know, more romantic subject matter. It really depends. So does a show have to be theme oriented? No. Not if you don't care if you sell a lot. But I mean, maybe it will sell a lot. I don't know. There's no easy answer for that. But I don't think it has to. I think depending on the gallery you're in, if you're in a Western gallery and you want to put all nudes in a show, they're going to have a problem with that. They're going to say, we don't sell that kind of stuff. We don't sell nudes. So you want to make sure that whatever, you know, gallery you're in or whatever area you're representing, that you think about that when you put a show together. You know, you don't want to be in a show that has nothing to do with a gallery that has nothing to, you know, a show put together, a show that has nothing to do with the type of gallery that you're in. So all this stuff has to be thought about. But what kind of painter you want to be, I know some painters that I really admire that aren't as interested in selling, but more interested in painting things that they like. So they travel around the world, and one year they'll be in India, and next year they'll be in Peru, and they'll do a painting series of Peru, and then they'll be away from Peru, and they'll travel through the Orient, and next thing you know, it's paintings from China. And they basically, every show is its own unique thing. And that's kind of more the business model or the way that I want to paint. I just want to travel. I always wanted to do that. Travel, come back, paint 20, 30 paintings, sell them, move, go somewhere else, see something else, come back, spend a year or two painting that stuff, go somewhere else, and just mix it up and don't ever get bored, you know? If I choose this genre, Indians, or cowboys and Indians, and then I decide I want to do a show of nudes, you know, it may not go over very well, you know? My collectors might say, well, I want his Indians, that's what he's known for, I don't want to buy a nude of his. So you might sell a few paintings, but you may see a huge drop-off in the interest in your work in that show because it's not what you're known for, you know? We got, like, messages coming in. We got that's awesome. I'll have to move that out at break. But anyway, so as I'm doing this hillside here, I've got silhouettes of pine trees, some darker, some lighter, some in front, some in back. Right now, it's probably best just to get a silhouette that looks cool, and then I can bust in and out of it, making trees come forward and back. So right now I'm thinking of it more as a silhouette, more than I'm thinking of it as individual trees. And a few of them I started to kind of indicate as individual trees, but you'll see, again, this is all about indicating things, indicating shapes, indicating masses. And that's kind of how we want this thing to come together. So in this area, for example, behind the horse, I'm not going to worry too much about painting individual trees yet. I'm just going to get a nice stain around, or, you know, and it's more than a stain. It's a little more opaque than a stain. Because, again, I need this horse to interact with the background. I need the background to interact with the horse. So I need a push and pull, ultimately. But how do you know what to do first? How do you know how much of what to do first, second, third? That's the art of layering. That's every problem that you run into in art is a layering problem, whether you want to think of it that way or not. It's what to do first, what to do second, what to do third. Do I put the trees on over the background? Do I put the background on after the trees? It's not always like you have to do it this way, but you do need to think in terms of layering and think about, it's like playing a chess match with yourself. You know, you want to think about like, okay, if I make this move and then I make that move, then that's going to happen and this is going to happen. Then I'm going to do this, this, and this. And then if all goes well, I've got checkmate and a nice painting. But it's this buildup. And that buildup, you learn how to do that by making mistakes. You build up a painting and you blow it three quarters of the way in and ruin a perfectly good effort. And you learn from that, hopefully, and next time you handle it a little differently. And so there's no way to prevent those mistakes from having to be happen. I hopefully, through showing you techniques, can minimize the amount of trial and error and frustration you're going to have to go through with that. And that's the goal of any good teacher or any good school. They're not painting paintings for you, but they're helping to give you direction so that you can more efficiently and quickly build yourself up to a higher level without having to go through all the trial and error that a lot of times takes a lot of time and energy that we don't have. And if you're struggling already and you're trying to get good and you're fighting having to get good on your own by self-education, it's a long, tedious road that may never get you where you really want to go, because you're, as you're trying these all these things, you're also making mistakes that are being ingrained. You're building bad habits that you didn't know you had to have, that you're even getting, and then later someone really knowledgeable has to show you that, or you have to see that somewhere and then make those adjustments. And that's what takes people forever to get good, is their training is so haphazard and so random that there's no way you could pull good sequence out of that or good procedure. I mean, it would be almost impossible. So here I'm swallowing up some of those trees. I'll pull them out later. Right now I'm looking more for the silhouette that's being created back there. I want a lot of busyness. I want a lot of activity. I want it to look like there's lots of trees back there. But I don't have the time to really, again, this is how I'm handling it. You'll see how it comes forward in future layers. Now the darks that I'm putting in here, I have to be a little careful that these darks, they're gonna dry lighter, because I know that gouache, the darks dry lighter and the lights dry darker. So I'm not too worried about that right now. But that's starting to come forward further than I think it should for where it's located in the picture plane, atmospherically. So I have to think about that and say, okay, maybe we dump a little lighter green into it while it's still a little wet, and that way I can get it tempered down a little bit, because I think it's a little dark. But you know, some of the dark darks in the deep crevices between the trees may very well compete with some of the intermediate darks in here and still be fine because of you've got to think about so many things. You've got to think about the actual inherent value of the object itself, and that you might have a value in the foreground that is lighter and a darker valued object in the middle ground that has darker shadows than the foreground one because of the inherent value of that object, the rock, the whatever it is you're talking about. And I don't want to confuse you too much with that, but that's where that whole idea of the darks in the middle aren't as dark as the darks in the front might break down a little bit sometimes in concept as you get into middle, foreground, middle ground, background type scenarios. And again, it's something that through observation and watching other good artists and working around good artists, you'll pick up how to handle that kind of stuff. But that's kind of more really fine-tuned information on dealing with higher level execution in landscape and stuff, which we'll get to down the road. But right now we don't have the time to address all those things in such a short demo. But I will address it in other phases and classes and stuff that we teach at the atelier and online and stuff. But again, for some of you out there, you may want to venture out to our school at some point or some other school similar to it to try to get some of this kind of training. But it's getting easier and more options, so it's nice. It's a good period to be an artist. It's a good period to be a person wanting to learn art. Way better than it was the last 30, 40 years, so you're in a lot better shape now.
Jeff, when you're drawing trees, do you approach drawing the trees in gouache different than you would be doing in oil?
A little bit, just because of how fast my edges dry. In gouache, I can get interesting looking splintery edges almost effortlessly. And in oil, that's going to be mushing with the background, and the edges are going to get all soft and gooey, and it's hard to get those really crisp, splintery edges that are so effortless in gouache. And that's one thing I just love about gouache, is the ability to get those splintery edges without even having to think about it, because it's such a pain in the butt in oil, because it's so gooey and takes so long for them. Anyway, so yeah, a lot of times palette knives, and I use a lot more of my fingers in oil, like stamping and getting like little activity and noise and stuff. You'll see me use it a lot in gouache too. But now we're going to have some trees that are, some pieces of trees that are bent over. We don't want everything to be completely vertical. So we want some of our shafts of our trees to be slightly off kilter, meaning at a slight angle, so that it gives it, doesn't have this, again, cookie cutter look of trees that just were stamped out or something. And again, the trees will grow along crease lines in the rock. They'll bust through the little cracks in the rock. And then, so a lot of times you'll see trees running in really precarious or odd little sequences of trees, and that's where the rock is split open, and there's a little bit of soil in there, and the trees will come up through there, and they're not coming up as much where the rock is totally dense and smashed together. So you'll see that the tree lines a lot of times do follow these precariously odd straight lines of trees, and then there'll be nothing, and then you'll see another couple ones growing up somewhere back here in kind of almost a straight line of each other, because that's probably where a crack exists. And so things like that are where you want to kind of, again, having gone out and hiked a ton and traveled a lot and observed these things from real life situation, I'm not a geologist, but I have a lot of observational experience by having been out there and seen lots of stuff and observed lots and remembered lots. Not just gone on a hike, but gone on a hike to retrieve information that could later benefit me at some later date. Could be 2 years after that, it could be 5 years after that. But always on reconnaissance, always learning, always training, always studying. You're a student of life, really. You're a student of observation and things that are around you. And what a cool way to go through life, because you're going to get a lot more out of it. You're going to see more, you're going to experience more, you're going to, than the average person who just kind of drives along and ho-hum and listen to their music and doesn't even look at the beautiful lighting scenario that's happening right outside their window and of their car, and they're just, you know, kind of in some other world. But artists, man, their goal, their idea is to bring beauty into the world, and you've got to think that way all the time. You've got to always be looking for it and watching nature. Nature's your best way of teaching you that. It's going to really be the best teacher of beauty. And it does it so effortlessly. Again, it doesn't care about asymmetry. It doesn't care about giving you the perfect tree. Your job is to design a tree that you think is your perfect tree, but the tree that you're seeing in front of you may, but nature does it so effortlessly that it's hard to duplicate its randomness. It's so good at just randomly doing stuff that's one thing you want to take out of nature, is its ability to create harmony out of almost complete chaos. And just looking at how nature does that, and it, you know, whether it's just how logs fall across a river and how some are dilapidated, some are semi-dilapidated, some have different tone. There's just this organic beauty to them that's very difficult to invent. But if you are around it a lot and you see it in nature a lot, it helps to facilitate an understanding of it, so that when you're doing your own fictitious pieces, your fantasy pieces, your invented pieces, there's an inherent quality that comes out in it that's unexplainable. But it's probably from observational learning from reality, and then bending that into fictitious worlds, different things. But you want your human beings to relate to the designs that you're doing if you're a concept or a visual development person. If they can't relate, then you've kind of failed as a designer. I mean, if it's so weird, so abstract, so nutty that you can't even understand it, I think you kind of missed the point. So, but anyway, that's a whole nother area is design in concept visual development. So I popped a little tree over the top of the other tree. Now I've got a tree in front of the other trees. So you can start seeing how I can start getting this layering happening and the illusion of depth and complexity with just random shapes that are being created. I'm not premeditating every shape. There are some trees where I'll say, I would like that tree to be right up there, and I'm going to premeditate that. But a lot of times it's just watching what abstractions happen and letting those guide you. So they become I might see some shape that accidentally created itself that I could have never thought of. That's what we call a happy accident. It's an accident that happens. It wasn't intentional, but man, I'll take it when they happen, because you got to be on the lookout for them. So painting is such a dynamic process. You know, it's always moving and morphing. You think you got your handle on it, and it just throws you a left hook. You know, it throws you a curveball. You thought it was going to be a fastball. You know, it's like all of a sudden, whoa, what just happened there? You know, that was crazy. So always being ready. Okay, what are we at time-wise?
It's 2:33 right now, so we're probably due for a break.
Okay, so we're going to take a little break and just take a look at what's going on, and we'll be back here in about 3 to 4 minutes, 5 minutes. I'm not going to take huge breaks because I want to work through as much as I can. But it's starting to come around, you know. Again, it's so early, it's ridiculous. But the gouaches do come around pretty fast, so just keep an eye on it, and we'll be back in a second. Right. Any questions coming in?
Yeah, a couple more. Wow.
There's a couple more in there?
Yeah, the last one was that son's two down here.
Right, the Pavel?
Under Pavel.
Hey, Pavel, what's going on? Let's see, in all 45 beads, okay, I got that one. How diluted is the paint you're using right now? Do you ever use gouache straight or essentially from the tube? Yeah, I do. But right now, I mean, we're building up layers, so I don't want my paint to be ridiculously opaque. So it's getting opaque in areas, and it ultimately will be, mostly, but not like right out of the, I just don't go straight, you know, usually right out of the tube this early in a painting. So for mapping the figure, do you map the shadow and the halftone or just the shadows? For mapping the figure, do you map the shadow and the halftone or just the shadows? I map everything. Yeah, so I contain my halftone shapes. I contain my, I'm always looking to design and contain the shapes. So, I'm always mapping almost everything. And then you can always lose the map or downplay it. But mapping is really designing your shapes rather than just smudging around tone hoping that it looks cool. So you're more deliberately designing what you see versus just copying. Like a lot of times you look on a model and there will be the illusion of just a tone. And if you just put it in the way you see it, it is going to look like a bruise, maybe some dirt smudged on the model. But if you contain it into some kind of geometric shape, a lot of times it has a lot more integrity and looks a lot better. So hopefully that answered that question. Okay. Alrighty, so We'll go ahead and get back on it. I'm going to try to get these trees laid in here just to get that out of the way. Then I'll go back and work some of the background, and then we'll get back into the foreground. So again, right now I'm starting my process of layering background to foreground, foreground to background, and working my way between these different positioning. The sky, there's not a lot of sky, so usually the old axiom in landscape painting is if you have a complicated sky, you have a simple foreground. If you have a simple or a complicated foreground, you have a simple sky. So obviously we have a very complicated foreground. Complicated, we have Indians, we've got rivers, we've got streams, we've got all this stuff going on. So we're going to want to keep that sky really mellow. No big cumulus nimbus, crazy clouds, none of that kind of stuff. Just real simple. So right now, again, it looks pretty haphazard the way I'm doing the trees. And it really is because, again, it's a lot faster than I normally would want to, but it's really about getting these abstract shapes in and then massaging them and making them really special. And we'll get there, but we have to get there through these kind of, you know, some way. And so, again, whether you use your finger to stamp in to give the illusion of pine needles or whether you want to paint them by hand or... you're not going to see pine needles that far back, right? So it's going to be masses of shape that look... So think like Watchell or, you know, Edgar Payne or any of the great designers of pine trees. You know, I can think of a ton of them. If you look at landscape painters, Schmidt is awesome at them, Richard Schmidt. So, you know, it's just, you know, picking and choosing. And you're going to want to create a file of images from which to work from, you know, like, so you want to get a lot of books on good landscape painters if you want to be a landscape painter, if you want to be a figure painter, same thing. So you should always be collecting material. Now with the online stuff, I mean, with the internet, you can so easily find so much information on these different artists and all kinds of stuff. So there's really not a lot of excuses for not having access to, you know, good stuff, you know. So again, I'm picking from, you know, my palette over here, and it's basically a warm, cool palette with some supplemental colors in it. So it's got a warm, cool red, warm, cool yellow, warm, cool blue, like almost every good palette does have. And then it has like burnt sienna, which is supplemental. It has sap green, supplemental. It has phthalo green, supplemental. So it has a few supplemental colors that, and see all that nice splintery that I had now is gonna get destroyed as I go through it. So that's why I was saying I could do that early, but is it going to be retained? Well, knowing that I have to go through the background and get some darker trees behind it and different, you know, again, I can change the trees can be brown, some can be brown red, some can be dead and white kind of trees. So we have all kinds of opportunities in that background to get abstractions of color notes, mostly subdued color notes, nothing bright, nothing garish. You know, you're not going to have some pure chroma object in a green, sap green tree. You know, unless it's man-made.
So. Hey, Jeff, we got a good question from Extensive Films. You'd like to know, do you have anything off to the side to remind you of the light direction in the painting, or do you establish the direction in your mind and just keep painting that idea in there while painting?
Well, normally you want to pick your dominant, like, kind of, either you're going to pick your guys on horseback that were pulled off another piece of photo reference and force them into the whatever one the dominant... Whatever your best piece of reference is what I would say. Right now, you know, I prefer to find the landscape that works, and then the guys that I have to put into it will probably be made to force themselves to conform to the lighting that was in the dominant source in the actual reference. Now, when we get into really complex invention of lighting scenarios, it is way complicated and way more in-depth than I could handle in any kind of three-hour demo. I can show you here, but to explain all the concepts and where they're coming from and what kind of information I learned in order to get those skill sets and stuff, that is way complicated. Lots of years of plein air painting, lots of years of invented concept work, a lot of years of, you know, studying Frazetta and different people and looking at different people that I like the way that they created their, you know, their illusions of reality, so to speak. So again, you know, I'm thinking right now that these guys have to somehow feel natural. It's a very subdued lighting scenario. And me, and to me, it's too boring. It's flat lit, it's gray, which again, some people find very appealing. So either it has to be a mood piece or it has to be an ambiance piece. Like right now, it's just kind of an ambiance piece. It's what would make it more dramatic was if some, and again, I could easily do this, and I may very well do this in this painting, we could pretend, we don't know what's going on above us, right? All we know that it's kind of a gray day. But do we know that there's no light popping through a cloud from above? Think like Hitchcock. We don't know what's going on to the left of the image. We don't know what's going on to the right of the image. We don't know what's behind us, and we don't know what's above us. All we can see is a tiny sliver of sky. If I want to break up that sky a little bit back here, which I may very well do, because I can kind of see in my reference a little bit of blue sky, kind of, or a little bit, then I basically open up that opportunity to put raking light anywhere I want to in this piece that would make sense, that would make it a better painting. I could create a little raking light that comes through here, kicks over the water, trickles down through here, puts this guy into shadow, then clips this guy back here with a little bit of rim light, or I can illuminate the front guy and put the other guys into cast shadow behind him. Whatever, however I want to highlight this idea, I can do it, believably, by using concepts of what's going on above us, behind, left of us, right of us, and so no one can really call me on it, unless I really get goofy with it, and make it so fictitious and goofy looking that I break some general rules. But if I play my cards right, I can do all kinds of stuff, whatever tells the best story. And so if I was to do this piece, I would probably do two or three comps like this, not quite this large, maybe 3/4 the size of this, or maybe half the size of this. And I would try out 3 or 4 different lighting scenarios. And I would pick from that after I was done, which one I thought was a strong. I'd ask a couple of my good friends, and I'd have my dad play art director, or Eric, or Lucas, or any of these guys. And I would go in and I would say, okay, which one do you like best? And just kind of run through these 3 comps and let them choose the one they like most. And then I would contemplate which one I like most. And then ultimately, I would make my decision based on a combination of what they gave me as far as input and what I, what I liked. And so that's kind of how, I don't know if that really answered your question. I hope it did. But it's a lot more complex than just, you got to find a dominant light source somewhere. Or again, my favorite lighting is gray days where there's cloud cover, because I can pop light anywhere I want on the scene. I can illuminate any object on the scene. The only thing you have to worry about when you do that is becoming a little too contrived by putting the center of interest, a little dappled light that hits perfectly on the Indian in the front and just illuminates him in such a way that it just looks cheesy. You just go, oh my God, that's just so angelic. It makes me want to puke, you know? So you don't want to do that. You want to, you want to give it, so sometimes the no-brainer would be, yeah, I want this guy to be the center of interest, so therefore I'm going to put rim lighting or hit a little bit of light coming down here and perfect light him. But then it becomes really almost whimsically contrived, and we don't want to do that either. So I think it's just a matter of finding balance, striking balance in all that stuff, and thinking about your favorite images you've seen over the years, different artists, Frazetta, it comes to mind as far as drama, but sort of how Turpin handles this stuff. Depending on the genre you're in, you may want to go find the best people in that genre, because there's always somebody that stands out as the heads and shoulders above everybody else as far as staging, integrity, all that kind of stuff. And when I think of Western art and stuff like this, I think of Howard Turpin, Z.S. Lang, James Reynolds, Bill Anton. These are guys, all contemporary guys I paint with in the Prix de West and shows like that. And they're extremely good picture makers. A lot of them are ex-illustrators that have gone to fine art, and when they went to fine art, they went into Western because it was a genre that you could make a really good living at fairly quickly if you were good. So a lot of them went into that. So I look at a lot of them. I have files of images from them that I've pulled out of magazines. I'm constantly looking at what they're doing. I go on their websites. I check out, what kind of, what they've been up to, and look at their work, and I'm always looking for new ideas, looking for new ways of handling things. And they'll be doing the same thing. They'll be looking at me, they'll be looking at other guys, they're looking at whoever they think they could borrow from that might help them get further along in their career. So you have a lot of people that are borrowing from a lot of other people, and that's, there's nothing really fundamentally wrong with that. It's just, it can be a little frustrating when you come up with it, you work really hard and come up with a really cool style or something, and then somebody just steals it wholesale. But you don't have a copyright on it, so the best thing you can do is be more knowledgeable and quicker and more efficient than the next person. And because all art is really more individual, but when you get to a professional level, it does become somewhat competitive. But you want to try to see the competitive aspect of it as not maliciously competitive, but in a very healthy way, I think. And again, I can only say that. Over the years, I've tried to exercise that as best I can in my own career. But you'll see people that do unscrupulous stuff, and it'll make you kind of mad. But they usually don't last that long because it's, again, like I said, it's a small world out there. And sometimes you'll see, again, I think it's best to try to come up with your own original style over time. But you'd be kind of... It would be stupid to think that you're going to somehow, well, I would say it's stupid to think, but careless to think that you might be able, I don't think you're going to be able to come up with a way of putting paint on a surface that hasn't already been done by somebody, either dead, long dead, recently dead, or presently living. So, you know, you're always going to be compared to somebody. They're always going to say, oh, your work looks like Fechin, oh, your work looks like Turkmen, oh, your work looks like Frazetta. Ultimately, you want to be someone where they say, oh, your work looks like Jeff Watts. Oh, your work looks like, you know, so-and-so. But in order to get there, we probably are going to be associated in our earlier years as a professional with somebody. Like, people always say, oh, you're the guy that paints like Fechin. And I'm like, well, first of all, that's an incredible compliment. Thank you very much. But at the end of the day, I would be like to be known as Jeff Watts, not Fechin Jr. or something, you know? So for me... my influences are easy to spot, but almost anybody out there I could in 2 seconds figure out who they're emulating. It's not that easy. It's not that hard to discover. I mean, it's easy to see. So the main thing is just pick good people to emulate. Pick people that you would be proud to be associated with. Would be my take on it is make sure that they're people that, you know, that in the, you know, you want to be synonymous with the great painters of the past as well as the contemporary great painters, I think. But try to be original. Try to cultivate your own original ideas and concepts. When we're training people, we train by emulation because it's the fastest, quickest way to proficiency. So you'll see me encouraging a lot of the younger students to, you know, embellish or to do master studies and things like that as they're coming up so that they can get a quicker handle on what it's like to, you know, their identity by using somebody else's identity that's already been through all that. And that's kind of where all of us are. We're all somewhere along that road of finding ourselves as painters and artists. Coming through. I can still see my drawing coming through, these stains. The stains are getting progressively darker and more intense as I build up to higher levels of the painting. So the painting is starting to come into more focus. Any questions over there?
Not yet.
Okay. So down in here, it's quite a bit darker. And like I said, it's a lot of rock that's wet. And so we're probably going to have some diluted greens. And to build this painting up a little faster, you know, you'll start seeing me get a little more aggressive with the stains on top of the older stains that I had. They'll still come through. Some of them will get compromised a little bit, but stains don't easily reactivate, and that's why it's kind of nice, because I can go over them pretty quickly and still have them retain a lot of their integrity. And when the paint's a little more opaque, like we've learned in portraiture, the paint will reactivate a lot easier. So again, I'll build the painting up, I'll tear it back down. When I tear it down, I'll blow through some edges I wish I had back again, but then I can always go back and get them, inject them back in. So right now, I'm softening lots of edges as I blow over it with this darker stain. So literally, we have subsequent layers of stain that are coming up to opaqueness in the whole painting. And that's kind of how we're going to work this painting out, is through subsequent stains. It should get, you know, with each subsequent level that I put on, it gets more and more finished, more and more looking like a painting. Okay. So down in the foreground, right, we've got our painting starting to happen, but in the foreground, we still have some dark water shapes. Again, the water is churning around as it comes down through this, cascading through this chasm. And at the bottom, you know, you get a lot of agitation in the water. kind of swirling, you know, crests of little, just agitation. So I'm kind of getting in there right now, and I'm trying to go in with a dark black with a little bit of phthalo green. So it's a really dark green. And for all practical purposes, when you look at it on the surface, you can't even tell that it is green. It just looks like black. But when lighter colors hit it later and things like that, or get into it and I do some blending, it'll reactivate that paint and the inherent green quality of it will start to come back out. Now at this stage, you could go in and do, again, a little bit more of a watercolory type. Water is its own thing, man. And I do it, you know, again, if I had tons of time, I would be more careful and relaxed about it, but you know, I'm just gonna kind of go in and have some fun with it and see if I can work a corner up so you can watch what I'm doing. Thinking about straights and curves, I'm thinking calligraphically, I'm using a nice brush that'll give me nice little calligraphic strokes and stuff. And the key thing is water. I mean, it's like anything, it's reflective, but it's also, when it's agitated, you get like interactions between lighter and passages, you know, lighter and darker passages. And since it's primarily a dingy greenish kind of color, you know, we're going to get, you just have to watch how it comes up. I mean, I can sit and theorize about it all day, but, and there's so many good painters out there that handle water brilliantly. But I've always enjoyed painting water, moving water, especially waterfalls are very fun for me. I've always enjoyed handling those. So let's get in there. Again, kind of handling it a little bit like a watercolor. The darkest darks are closer to the rock because the rock's reflecting into the water, creating a shadow, even though the water's agitated in the water. And as we get further out, away from that rock ledge, the water's gonna reflect more of the sky, which is kind of a gray overcast. So that'll be a lighter green than obviously it is closer to that this dark right here, which needs to be darker, by the way. Some of these will be intermediate areas where I'll go in with darker greens over the top of them. Yeah, just constantly back and forth. So water's a layering process, not that dissimilar from the pine trees we're dealing with in the background there. The way it's just being really good at creating abstraction of shape, abstract shapes. And as the little ripples pass up and down, just like crests on a wave on the ocean, some of them are reflecting at different angles, different objects around them, sky, some reflecting water. So, you know, like the white water. So as the waves are cresting and doing this kind of wavy thing, they're catching high points of reflections off different things. So in some ways it's very maddening to try to track that 100% logically. It's better, I think, to try to get the illusion of it, a believable illusion of it, through understanding the general concept of it. And I know a lot of this sounds really, you know, really abstract, but it's really not. At the end of the day, it's an effect that you're trying to capture. If you capture that effect, you're good. You can theorize it, you can rationalize it, whatever you want to do, but it just needs to read at the end of the day. So I'll go back in now in between those high points of the water and maybe put a little bit different green stain over those to knock them down a little bit, because I don't want them quite that punchy. But see, the earlier stains I put in are stained because they're stains. So it actually works to my advantage right there, as I'm, because I don't want to lose them all. Some I don't mind if they blur out a little bit. Again, it's a cumulative process of building up the water. So it's not just boom, done, boom, done, boom, done. It's pulling it up, breaking it down, pulling it up, breaking it down, constantly back and forth until the subtle effect that you're looking for occurs. So here I've mixed a little bit of black and white into the green to make it more of a gray. As it encroaches into the turbulent white water that's still very white, it becomes a little more gray in there rather than green. So you might see me take a little white and a little bit of cobalt blue, mix it in with that green a little bit, so that now it's more of a neutral gray. And within this this whitewash here, I want, you know, little abstract shapes, and I'm just going to create them. I can look at the reference occasionally for just for inspiration, but I'm not going to take inventory. It's kind of like painting hair. Last thing I want to do is take inventory of every little, you know, twist and turn of the water, every little foam pattern. But I do want a foam pattern that at the end of the day has a nice balance of straights and curves, hards and softs, thicks and thins, all those kind of things. But again, that's somewhat of an intuitive thing that you develop over years of just designing different things, arms, legs, tech. All that stuff helps to cultivate a design sense. That design sense will carry into anything you design, whether it's a car, water, moving water, tree, head. So ultimately, it's not so much a formula, but it's a way of thinking about solving shape. The more shapes you solve, the more intimately connected with shape design you become. The more great artists you study, Leyendecker, Mucha, the great, beautiful designers that have come in different areas. There's great designers in landscape, there's great designers in portrait, there's great designers, some great designers in all areas. But you want to, you know, familiarize yourself as much as possible with these different designers, and then ultimately put your own spin on it and become a great designer yourself. But to think that you're going to pick up a book on design and learn how to design, you know, you got another thing coming. I don't think it's going to happen. I haven't seen that book yet. It's a cumulative process that builds with many layers of knowledge over many, many years of doing it, many different areas, that I think cultivates the best designers. So now in this water, we have this kind of cascading where it comes down, drops off a ledge. And as it does that, we have rock that's coming through a little bit. We also have a change in value a little bit as the water turns away from the light source. So we start to get, again, this illusion of layering of what's going on. The water is passing over the anatomy of the rocks. The rocks have a certain anatomy to them. We can't always see what's going on under the water, but we can see there's a shelf here. Does that shelf magically just disappear as it goes across the water? Probably not. It's probably still there underneath the water. So we have a shelf that's carrying somewhere, not perfectly straight across from that, but maybe it drops down a little bit and comes back up, which it looks like it might be doing. We have another series of rock right here where the water is coming around the corner and then dumping off of another sequence of rocks to the right here and right underneath that shelf. And that's going to have some shadows being cast maybe in the water. So we'll take that blue-gray, that dingy blue-gray that I have, and we'll sprinkle that in. You know, again, just making abstract shapes out of it, somewhat referring to my reference, and then, but not being literal by any stretch of the imagination. Back here is the water. So again, you can slowly see in it start to take shape. It's by no means in the great design category yet, but it will get there, I hope. It's my intention. In the meantime, I'm working feverishly just to get, you know, the concept across. So, but that's looking good. Okay, so now we have most of the foreground kind of laid in. We've got some of the water working. We've got some of the middle ground in. We don't really have the background yet here or the sky in. So in a minute, we might want to tackle that. The question would be, well, one of the questions may be, do we do the trees first and then paint the sky around it? Do we paint the sky or the trees over the sky? It's usually a combination of both. So I'll get up here and get a little bit more of that tree and then maybe use my finger to stamp a little bit in it there. I'm going to go back into that far hillside there. And I notice that it's kind of flat lit, and it's just these big slate kind of pieces of a hill that have broken off over the centuries and the millennia, and basically sheared off the side of the cliff. That could have been from a glacier going through there. It could have been from an earthquake. It could have been from just time and just all of a sudden the rock got too heavy and split off and fell down to the bottom. But you always see this stuff they call scree, which is the rock that's fallen off of the hill at the base of a lot of slopes. And it's just really the old rock that's being almost recycled or shed off the side of the mountain. And so I'm not going to take inventory of that, but I'm aware that it's happening. So I'm creating little darker passages in the rock of diluted gray, because it's kind of a, again, it's like a, it's a, not a slate as much as probably a granite or something. But it's kind of got a grayish, it's got some warm grays in it. It's got cool grays in it. Some of the veins have more of a peachy, pinky kind of look to it. And some of the veins run, again, across the rock, some down the rock, some in between. So you just don't want to run straight lines all the way across, but occasionally you want to pop in a few horizontals against the verticals to, again, give the illusion of complexity back there, that there's something going on. And there is a lot going on, and it's so much that I don't want to really get into to it 100%, but I want to get an illusion of it. Now, the trees that are clinging to the hillside way back in the distance are, oh man, they're pretty far back there. I don't know, 10 miles back, 5 miles back, I don't know. They're back there a ways. So these don't want to be chromatically bright, and they don't want to be extremely dark. So we want to gray down a green. So how do we gray green? Well, the component of green is red, so we can always put a little cad orange in it or cad red in it to take some of the green out of it, so it becomes more of a neutral gray-green. And then we want to kind of sprinkle, damn, there goes my train, sprinkle that along some of those crease lines, again, that I was talking about, where they seem to grow along these lines of breaks in the granite. So you just can arbitrarily pick it. You really can just randomly sprinkle them around if you want, wherever it seems like it needs a little bit of... So I got to be careful that I'm not too literal in my reference, because I don't really always love my reference. Most of the time I don't. I like aspects of it, but I'm still going to look at it very abstractly and ask myself if there's some trees that need to be pruned, if there are some areas that need to be injected, some more information needs to be injected in them, something like that. Okay, so over here we have all kinds of little pencil crease lines that I've kind of gesturally... You know, again, I might want to take my brush around, I'm using a round, and just kind of pick up some of the big split lines in the granite, and just kind of go in and actually delineate them as if I was inking or something. I'm just going to actually outline them. And I'm going in, and I'm kind of going along here, and then topographically, you know, they're kind of, I don't want them to be too generic. I don't want them to, you know, go too far, too long with the same width of line or the same intensity of line. So you'll see me push and pull calligraphically, almost like I'm, again, inking or watercolor. But watercolor and inking are very finesse-driven mediums where they're really calligraphic mediums. Well, calligraphy, you know, so it's a push and a pull and a thick to a thin line as you pull the brush. So they're a little, it's more complicated in some ways than drawing, certain drawing techniques and stuff. We talk about a lot of that in a lot of I do a lot, I know. You know, but you have to have gotten good at a lot of different mediums to be able to know that, to know which ones are, you know, do what and under what circumstances and all that kind of stuff. So again, following the topography, splitting and going other directions with the topography occasionally, so I don't get into any kind of generic rhythm. Occasionally look up at the reference and see if I can pick something I like. Now I'm going to create my own version of it, depending on how things are going. Okay. Alrighty. Sky. Yowza. Skies are best done. I mean, they're art in and of themselves, that's for sure. I like to start with the white clouds because, again, it's easier to break those down. You want the clouds to be somewhat kind of usually, they're not going to be ridiculously warm, but they want to have kind of a warmth to them, and the blue of the sky is so cold that when you bust into it, you know, it's hard to get back the warmth if you don't. So I start with my cloud mask, so that's what I'm doing right now. So I mix up some white and I start to sprinkle it in, right? And I shoot right through my trees, I can put the trees on later, and I'm going to have to. That's why, you know, to paint these really beautiful edged trees, and then what are you going to do when you have to put the sky in? Well, you're going to have to go right through them. So just kind of watch how I do it. So if you're real fastidious and you go, oh my God, I painted that little careful tree and I can't go through it and I just put too much work into it, you're going to be really hurting trying to do a sky around that area. You've got to be okay with blowing out areas that you've already done. They just, you know, you find them, you lose them, you find them, you lose them. Is there a perfect sequence somewhere out there? Maybe. I don't know of it. I mean, I'm and I've painted a lot. It's just, it's all, sometimes you wish you would have done one thing a little bit earlier. It's really tough to always know, but just watch. And again, the best way you're going to learn is by watching someone really good that's willing to lay it down right in front of you. There's nothing to substitute that I've seen. There's no books you're going to read that are better. It's got to be somebody that knows what they're doing. Hopefully I've got this board kicking up a little bit because it's it's just is what it is. Not even worth commenting on, really. So again, I keep going back and trying to get more bang out of my clouds. I want some kind of abstract shape back there, but I don't want it to be so interesting that it detracts from other areas. But right now, it might look more interesting, but as we get the granite in around it, we get the trees in over the top of it, it'll start to chill out a little bit. Now, I've made it a little bit bluer than in the reference, because again, I want to open up that opportunity to maybe put some light, dappled light in the foreground. And in order to do that, I need to make it not look like it's about to thunderstorm. You know, you can't make it look like it's so dark that there's no way that could be a possibility. But boy, nature can do almost anything. If you're up in the High Sierras, man, it'll be sunny 1 second, and 2 seconds later, you'll have a freaking downpour and thunderstorm come out of like nowhere in 5 minutes. It's the most amazing thing. So almost any kind of situation could happen that you could possibly imagine out in nature. Yeah, you just really can't underestimate what it's capable of. Okay, so sky's kind of in. Let it sit down. Probably going to cut back in with my blues in a second. Let it sit for a second and just chill. And, let it just hang out, and then we'll go do some other stuff here. So, you know, some people might get up in that corner and not be able to release it. Got to get that done. Got to finish it right now. Can't let it sit like that. Driving me crazy. If that's the way you're wired, then you'll have an interesting time painting. Not saying you can't, but you'll have to fight that tendency to want to hyper obsess in areas too long. So a lot of my initial darks were not dark enough. I mean, none of these are dark enough. None of this. So as I get back there and then back here, and then it's time to maybe revisit some of these areas and get back in there and start to bring them up to one more level of completeness, one more level of value. Pretty soon I'll have to revisit those guys again too. It's almost time for them to get a little TLC also. Yeah, this will probably be a two-stage. I'll do it again. I don't know. We'll see. But I think I'm going to need another amount of time on this. So maybe when I get back from, I'm only going to be gone for like 5 or 6 days. So the next time we do one of these, you may see me finish this one, and then we'll move back to some head drawing. If you guys have certain things you want to see us demo, I'm thinking about see if I can wrap Lucas into coming in and doing some dragon pieces or something. He's incredible. Concept visual development guy, fantasy artist that trained with me originally and now is just killing it out there professionally. So he's doing fantastic. Great guy. So I'd love to get him in here to do one. I know you've seen Eric do the zombie piece. But Eric can hold his own in almost anything. So you'll see everybody kind of coming in. I'll see if I can rope my dad into getting in here and doing one. Some kind of demo, tech demo or something. But we'll mix it up. It's not always going to be gouache. It's not always going to be drawing. I'm kind of on this gouache kick right now, so I decided to do a little, and I've got to teach landscape gouache this next term. So I might as well warm up a little bit for it. And I'm always trying to think smart about how if I'm going to do something like this, hey, might as well get some practice on something that I'm gonna have to do coming up here very soon. So, you'll see us do a lot of cool things, but if there's something you guys want to see, fire over some suggestions, and I'll see if I can put them in the queue. Okay, just throwing in more darks. Looking for ways of breaking up shapes, rocks, sides of, formations of rock, trying to be inventive and creative, not just being literal. I look at my reference, I ask myself really quickly inside my mind, is that what I want? Do I like that shape? Does that shape resonate with me compared to the shapes that are next to it? Does it need to be stronger? Does it need to be more curved? Does it need to be simplified? Is there too much complexity around there, and is it getting too confusing for the viewer? All these things are you having to reflect back on what you feel and what you're thinking and being interacting with this, not just being a slave to the reference and sitting and copying it verbatim because it's there. Well, that's what the reference was. Well, no one cares. No one's going to care. So at the end of the day, it either looks good or it doesn't. And if it doesn't, you can't blame anybody except yourself. So we got to take responsibility for creating nice shapes, for designing nice things, and not blame our reference, blame our training, blame anything. It's really your responsibility. If you have to sit and explain your piece, you probably failed, unfortunately, to somebody. It should communicate to the viewer that which it was intended. The way we do that, again, is by being extremely knowledgeable and injecting that knowledge into our pictorial arrangements, composition, color theory, anatomy, whatever the case may be. But it's all these things. So every time you sit down to do a piece, your knowledge base up to that point will be taxed probably to its ultimate level, or it should be. So that's why painting never becomes easy. Everyone says, oh, does it get easier down the road? It's like, well, it depends on how you look at it. But if you always want to be getting better and you always want to be moving forward and you always want to be pushing the envelope, no. It's only going to get harder because you expect more out of yourself. You've trained harder and longer, so you have more options. With more options come more decisions, but also more complexity in making decisions because now you have more things to think about. So you're always going to be engaged. And if so, art is for people that like to think. They like to problem solve. They don't look for the easy way out. They actually would rather look for the hard way. So it doesn't mean that if you're out there saying, well, that's not me, I'm really kind of lazy and don't like working that hard, doesn't mean you can't be a decent artist, but it's going to be hard because it just doesn't really want to do that. It's more engaging than that. So it does work best for people that really are looking for a challenge that will last the rest of their life, not a challenge that's for a week or two, but it is a challenging thing to do for a living, but one of the most rewarding that you'll ever do. If you turn it into a career, it'll be probably one of the coolest things that you ever did. But you'll earn it through training properly and hard work. So that's where we're at right now. Most of you are out there either going to school somewhere, or you've gone to school already, or maybe you're, I don't know, thinking of going to school or not sure whether you want to. I mean, I'm sure that there's a little bit of all that going around, and that's understandable. I mean, man, I was there years and years ago, and I just got lucky and made a good decision on where I studied and who I studied with. I wouldn't say that was lucky, because there was a lot of my dad and myself choosing to go that route versus some other routes that really paid off for me. But many of you will be having to make those same decisions, I would imagine, at some point, if you haven't already done so. So just be as educated as you can. Cross your, dot your I's and cross your T's. Look at your options in your local area. Look at your options financially, time-wise. All these things have to be considered, obviously, when you're talking about, you know, how to best train oneself in anything. Okay. My forte has always been training. I mean, it's my strength. My greatest strength is my ability to come up with creative ways to teach myself things artistically, visually. Because I'm heavily visually wired, I've spent most of my life, you know, there weren't that many other than my father, which I was so thankful to have around. You're kind of on your own in a lot of ways. I mean, because they just don't know what to do with you in school. They really don't know how to teach you when you're visually wired. So it's kind of left up to you to learn how to navigate developing that skill set. Some people are fortunate to have some decent high schools, and there are some good programs out there, which I'm so thrilled to see. But they're few and far between. So a little dry brush, when we get into this kind of cascading water and the spray and the mist, and there's a little mist coming up over the rocks, we haven't even got to all that fun stuff yet. That's the real, that's where it's really going to get, that's where I, you know, that's the finishing touches, that's fun, the fun stuff. Right now, we're setting it up for the fun stuff. Not that this isn't fun, it's just a little bit more like pick and shovel. You're kind of, it's like swimming, you know, digging a ditch or getting ready to dig a ditch, to lay a foundation, to put in a wall so that you can later veneer it with some beautiful stone that's going to look really cool. But the lower stages of it are just like, you, before you get that veneer on that looks really cool, you got to, you know, get the pick and shovel out and start digging a ditch. And there's nothing fun about that. That's the not so fun part of the process. But if you're smart and if you're insightful, you'll even learn how to make that fun. You'll find ways to create take the most mundane aspects of your training and turn them into games for yourself that are fun to learn from. And a great teacher will do that for you. That's their job. I had a great calculus teacher. Okay, how could you even have such a thing? You know, unless you're a math aficionado, it's not that fun, you know. But if you have a teacher that can relate to you and take those concepts and make them relatable and have come up with some fun analogies, some fun little exercises. I had a great teacher, and he made calculus fun to learn. That's made all the difference for me learning that particular academic area. So art's no different. You know, a good teacher will make learning this stuff really fun by coming up with creative ways to approach it. And in order to do that, you really have to enjoy it yourself. You have to have fun, you know, doing it on your own. I always tell my teachers, if it's fun for you and you're having a good time teaching it, nobody's going to be complaining because they're going to have fun. If you're going in and you're teaching it formulaically and you're burnt out and you're fried and you're phoning it in, your students are going to pick up on that and it's going to be miserable for everybody. So you got to come in and kind of, you know, for those teachers out there, you know, you got to make it fun for the kids, you know, you got to make it fun for yourself, make it really enjoyable, and they're going to love it, you know, they're going to rise to the occasion and see that kind of enthusiasm you have for it, and it's going to become infectious, and they're going to want to do it, and next thing you know, you got a really great class going with a lot of people having a good time and learning a lot, and that's, so I don't put a lot of parameters on my instructors. I trust them, I trained a lot of them, I know how good they are. Go have fun teaching this. Take the binder that we created. We've taught it 22 times. Try to make that class a little bit better. I don't care how you do it. I don't care what you do. Just make it, put your spin on it, and have some fun with it. And I don't micromanage the teachers, ever. You know, just if I hear a complaint, then I'll go talk to them. Otherwise, you're not going to hear anything from me, really. So it's kind of fun. It gives the teachers a lot of freedom to create classes, you know, that are uniquely theirs, but also build off of all the other people that have taught the class in our lineage at our atelier. So it just makes for a really robust, fun environment for people. Because there's nothing worse than having to come in and say, okay, you're teaching gouache landscape for the 50th time in the exact same formula, with the exact same exercises, with the exact, oh my God, I'd want to just jump off a bridge or something, you know? It just, not my thing. Not to mention that last time I taught this class, I've learned a ton since then. So I want to inject some of those things I've learned into the class now, or at least if I'm a good teacher, you'd think that's what you'd want to do. Draw upon your personal experience to make the class better, to make it more engaging, to make it more pertinent, more user-friendly for the people that are going to be using that information in their own careers, or their own certain areas. So now work in this little area right here, which has been neglected a little bit. Any questions back there? Anybody going on?
Nope. Pretty good.
Wow, man. Everybody's just nice and relaxed. What is everybody watching the World Cup? It's probably what's going on. All you Europeans out there. No, we're actually, it's been a fun World Cup. I mean, been pretty fun to watch. I used to play soccer forever. I was an avid soccer player before I was a cyclist, before I was a hardcore art student. So it's funny, every sport that I played, my wife always laughs because it's all European sports. You know, I mean, almost everything I was into was more of a European sport than an American sport. But it's nice to see cycling and the things that I was interested in becoming a little bit more mainstream over here as well. Getting a lot more love for those sports. They're such wonderful sports. Okay, so laying in some taupey colors, some peaches, some light blue grays. It's amazing how much variety of color you could get in that using only your grays. Grays are the glue that keep your colors together. Always remember that. Grays are absolutely necessary to a good painting. So a lot of people say, oh, my paintings get gray. And I'm like, well, what's wrong with that? I mean, that's what they're supposed to. I mean, grays are 90% of your painting. You pump a bunch of garish color in there, and it's going to look so bad and so contrived and trite, or it could, that a lot of times it's the grays that save you. It's the grays that glue all those pure color notes, if there are any. And when you go out into nature, you're going to realize there just aren't that many pure colors, unless it's man-made. Flowers, maybe, things like that. But it's just not that easy to find bright colors. On this day up in the Sierras, good luck finding anything that's even remotely bright, unless some backpacker's coming through with a red shirt on or something. I mean, you're basically stuck in grays, tons of them. So might as well make beautiful, luscious grays that harmonize off each other and have a beautiful glue-like quality to the composition. Just kind of getting some of the little bit darker, get rid of some of the little hot spots down here that are still remaining, that are just little areas I haven't gotten back to painting opaquely, but occasionally I can just borrow some of the tone just to knock down an area or start to, again, build up more of a nice cohesive feel. Okay, now I'm looking back up there. The sky caught my eye while I was chatting about that, and it's okay. Nothing to write home about, so I'm gonna go back up there and fix it a little bit. But I noticed I'm out of white, so whenever you run out of a color, make sure you just replace it immediately, because it will, otherwise it just, you know, you'll end up finding yourself, I can't obviously operate without white, but other colors that aren't as important, you might find yourself just using other colors instead of them and forget to put them out or be too lazy, and it can be a really bad habit. So up in here, I want to kind of opaquely replace the blue a little bit more opaquely. Yeah, something just to look, and looking at how I'm cutting into the cloud shapes and what kind of shapes, negative and positive, that are being created as from the silhouette around the clouds. And that's a little contrived, so I might want to blur out a couple of the edges, carry some of this blue a little bit back further and let it dissipate. And we can do some airbrush stuff back there too to really get it to come together a little later. So remember, gouache is a training tool. It's not necessarily one that you're going to hang your hat on for your career, but you never know. I love it. I think you see some fine art painters painting in it. You know, there's a couple of Chinese guys that use it, and it's not like you can't inject it out into the fine art arena. I've done it a little bit too, and I may do more of it. It's just a matter of, like anything, it's just getting really good at it. Great stuff in anything will do fine. I firmly believe that. virtuoso gouache painting injected into the gallery industry would do fine. You might have to spend some time re-educating the general public and collectors as to what it even is, but other than that, you know, I mean, I don't see any reason why you can't inject it back out in there and get some play out of it.
Hey Jeff, we've got a good question from Damian Anderson.
Mm-hmm.
Hey Jeff, I was wondering if you've ever used gouache for plein air studies. All of the plein air classes list oil as the materials. Does gouache just work better in the studio?
I mean, you know, we do an outdoor sketching class. I think Eric's teaching this next term that's part outdoor freehand perspective sketching. So you're getting used to eyeballing perspective and guessing while you're out there, which is the only way you can really do it plein air. And in that class, we tie gouache into it so that you do, usually two or three drawings, and then you pick one of them and you do a gouache painting on top of it. So it's kind of a combination outdoor sketching / outdoor gouache painting class. I've just recently, I go through phases with gouache where we have an extremely strong presence of it. Our school is probably one of the strongest presence in gouache. But, over the years, I've gone in and out of interest in it. I mean, not I've never lost interest in it, but sometimes I use it more than others. Sometimes I'm off in some other area, and I don't put it on the role as much. It's not being taught as much. Right now, we're kind of in a pretty tight, we have a lot of classes in gouache, and I'm kind of really hot on it again. So I'm kind of bringing it back into the school a little bit more. So, outdoor sketching in gouache is a phenomenal way to you can do plein air gouache, no problem. Have I done a ton of it? No, usually when I'm traveling, because I just don't like lugging around a bunch of oils anymore. I mean, I occasionally, depending on where I'm going, like I think I'm probably going to be visiting China in November, and I'll be taking oil on that one, but because it's primarily a plein air printing trip. But, I can, but as far as just a really user-friendly travel medium, if you just want to dink around while you're on a trip and you don't want to lug a bunch of stuff, you can't get better than gouache. And there's some guys online, some of them work in the gaming. I forgot the one guy's name, but he's a phenomenal, gouache painter guy that always is posting his stuff on Facebook. And it's really cool to see. I mean, he's just really good. He's always out. Anywhere he goes, he's got his gouache with him. It looks like he does like two or three a day or something. So, I mean, there's all kinds of different people out there. Nathan Falks or someone like that, who's just a phenomenal gouache painter, visual development guy over at DreamWorks, and also teaches up at LA Fig Arts and stuff. He can hold his own. He's amazingly good with gouache, and I really enjoy his stuff. So yeah, you'll see guys like that are still around, and my dad's a phenomenal gouache painter. I mean, one of the best I've ever seen. Just off the Richter scale good gouache. And so, it's neat. If I can help bring it back in some capacity, just because I hate to see old, beautiful things go to the wayside, just because, the church of what's happening now is kind of in command. So everyone's like, oh, digital, oh my God, it's the best thing that ever happened. And it's like, yeah, it's a really beautiful thing. It's wonderful, but it's not going to replace anything. It's just another cool medium. Just like when photography came in, everyone thought painting was going to never be the same and it was going to disappear because now we've got also, it never happened. It just became another good medium. So for me, I'm going to keep pushing to educate people as to what this medium is capable of doing, if nothing else, just for training. And use it for that in my own school, but also in my own personal, my life, I'll use it. And there's certain things you're going to learn from certain mediums that you just can't learn anywhere else. And digital is going to teach you certain things you can't learn except for in digital, and gouache is going to, and oil is going to. And so we want to keep a very open mind when we're training and not become closed-minded too quickly. At some point, yes, you're going to specialize, and you're going to have to probably specialize, and that's great. It'll happen whether you want it to or not. So if you can prevent it from happening too early and just keep pushing yourself to learn new things and to be very open to learning new things, I think you'll be a stronger painter in the long run and have more flexibility and ability to maybe do many different careers and things like that. So we're looking for tenacious artists that can survive any different scenario of things that might happen in the marketplace. Now or in the future. That's what I want to be. I want to be one of those guys where oh yeah, my, you know, what I used to do kind of dried up, but yeah, I just moved over into the other, this other industry and, you know, killing it over there now. You know, it's, it wasn't that big of a deal. It's kind of a minor inconvenience. But some people, it'll just bury them. They don't have the skills to move on. So when something dries up, it's like they don't have the ability to move on. And that's a shame because they might find themselves out of a career, you know, in art and have to go do something else. And once you're doing something else, it's hard to find the time to get back to doing your art because you're too busy doing something else. So you can get caught in a conundrum where you're, you know, you just don't want to get caught in a situation like that where you got to go take a job doing something you don't even remotely want to do to pay the bills. And you were doing art, but you weren't quite diverse enough to survive the dry up of a career, of a certain market or something. Like, you know, when the comics was early 90s, man, anyone, their half brother could have done comics and made a great living. You just had to throw out your hat and you'd get work. But then they flooded the market collapsed, and only the best of the best kept working, and the rest of them were out of work. And the good guys, some of the good guys went over into animation, some of them went over into new fields of animation and you know, like Pixar and places like that. But some of them just weren't able to roll with the punches and ended up kind of losing their career, and you never saw them again, you know? So you don't want to be one of those. So you just want to make sure that you're always working on building skill sets, even when you have a good gig going. Don't get complacent just because you got your job seems to be really nice right now. And I see a lot of guys in gaming and stuff like that, and I'm kind of always encouraging them, hey, you should get back in class. You should. I know it's hard, you know, you got families and this and that, and things you should be other things you'd like to be doing, and you work long days. I understand all that stuff, but you really just for their own longevity, they should be moving and building different skill sets while they can at leisure, because you know, you may want to move into a different industry. So anyway, I hope this is okay, the stuff I'm talking about. You guys aren't, you know, getting too bored with it.
We have a question from Lancelot Richardson.
Sure.
Do you think gouache has been having a recent revival? I've noticed more artists are trying it and more retailers seem to have it.
Well, I think, you know, schools like ours are pushing it. We're out here doing these demos online. We're showing people, you know. Some of you might get interested just from watching this demo or the last demo I did. Next thing you know, you go out, you buy some, you like it, you start working in it, you tell your friends about it. That's how movements get going. That's how things happen. But somebody's got to step up and, you know, get it going. So at some point, yeah, I think there is a bit of a resurgence. And most of it is coming from schools like ours. There aren't many that even know gouache or teach it. Not many colleges do. I don't see many even specialty art schools doing it. Everyone thinks it's passé, you know. Oh, yeah, that was gouache. That was back in the 50s. Yeah, no, that's that weird old medium that everybody used to use. You know, I think, again, I'm a contrarian. So whatever everybody else is doing, I'm going to do the opposite. I just am not interested in following the herd, you know. So if somebody's, you know, if gouache is out, then I'm going to be doing it. Why? Because I'll bring it back in, or I'll try to bring it back in. But I'm not going to be just doing what's hot right now. You know, because that's not going to be that hot by the time you get good at it. That's my dad used to always tell me that. But, you know, chasing styles and trying to get good at a style that seems to be viable in the marketplace right now, by the time you get good enough to do that particular style, the style is probably going to be out and dead. So you can't chase styles and you can't chase these things so much. You got to kind of find what you like, find what you're good at, stick with it, and bite your time until it comes around, or make it come around yourself. How? By doing such phenomenal work in gouache that nobody can deny it. Everybody wants to buy it. Why? Because it's that good. That's what you want to do. Just say, I'm going to do it so good that they cannot dispute it. They cannot, all they can say is that's awesome. And if you can do that, you will be able to find a place for it. You'll be able to do it for a living. You'll be able to find a niche for yourself. And then next thing you know, you'll have 50 guys trying to do it because, oh my God, look at so-and-so is doing it. Oh, and it's so, oh, you know, and the next thing you know, that's the next hot thing. So that's how you create a hot thing. You don't create it by following what's already hot. You follow your own lead, and then you make it. And then if you're, you know, and again, timing has a lot to play with that. There's a lot of things that have to come together for something like that to happen. But I think it's following your own heart, following your own interest, and not being swayed by everything that's being done out there. And right now, with this perception overload that we're all dealing with the internet, it's good and it's bad. I mean, you go on that thing, and there's so many good people, there's so many people doing so many crazy things that you can't even get your head around what you should be doing. There's so much stuff out there. So at some point, you got to just kind of pick your own battles honestly go after them and let them pay off if they're going to. And some will and some won't. You won't really know always which ones are going to pay off for you. But the main thing is do the best work you can. Do it at a level that's incredibly high as you can get it. If you can get it higher than anybody else, you're in good shape. If you can be one of the best at anything, I don't care what it is, you got a good shot. You got a good shot at doing something with it and having good success monetarily as well as professionally. But that's my best advice. And just knowing, because I've chased people's styles, I've done all the things I'm kind of telling you, and it hasn't worked for me. You know, and in hindsight, I go, yeah, I was doing exactly what people were telling me not to, but I didn't really quite listen to them, and I wasn't really quite paying attention, or I just, yeah, I didn't, whatever. But you know, experience will teach you those things, and I can share things with you, but you still may have to go and experience them for yourself, and I think there's much of it you will. And I by no means have the answers to everything, or even, all I know is I know a lot. I know how much I don't know now, and I know how much more work I have ahead of me, and I always will, and so I've kind of given into that, and I'm okay with that. I'm okay with the fact that I'll never be as good as I probably want to be. I'm okay with the fact that there's always going to be someone better that either is living or dead than me at certain things. But I'll do the best I can to be the best I can, and that's all I can do at the end of the day. And if I do that, what more can you ask from yourself or anybody? So it's all good. If that's what I feel like at the end of the day, then I'm a very fortunate person. So I'll continue to train hard. I'll continue to love what I do. If I don't, then I'll do something else. Move into some other area. But you have to have the guts to be able to know also when you're phoning it in, when you're kind of a bad parody of yourself. Because it can happen, you know, you just become a bad imitation of yourself after a while. And that's usually a good time that you need to kind of shake it up a little bit. You need to go try something that you're not good at. Try sculpting. Try a different medium. Try something, a different genre. Get out of your rut. Get out there and make a fool out of yourself. And get into an environment with better people that are way better than you. And be humbled and be okay with it. Yeah, you're a famous painter. Who cares? End of the day, I mean, come on now. The main thing is integrity and your work. And I mean, I've been in positions where I've lost my integrity with my work, and it sucks. It makes you feel bad about yourself. It makes you feel not so good. But those periods are great for reflection later. You think back and go, God, I'm so much further along now because I didn't quit during that period, but I did recognize that I was being unauthentic, and I just wasn't following my heart. I was painting for money, and that was it. And that always bites you in the rear. Doesn't mean you can't make great money, because I think a lot of us artists sacrifice as great or as much or more than many other professions, and yet seldom get the accolades and the financial rewards that we deserve for the sacrifices we've made. But if you are true to yourself and you do a good job, you will make a great living. How could you not? The whole world is propelled by visual people. But you've got to be really good. You've got to be really authentic. You've got to, all those things are things that can be very hard to learn. So I'm putting some greens in here. And there are some greens in the reference. Are we almost done? Or
no, you're good.
Are we good? Okay. Yeah, I got about 20 minutes left. So yeah, this is definitely going to be part one, part two. I was hoping, I was a little overzealous with the idea that I thought I might be able to finish it in one fell swoop. But it is a big gouache and it is complex. We've got figures, we've got cascading water, we've got trees, you've got a lot of stuff to deal with. But it's fun, you know? So hopefully you guys will have enough interest in watching it come to a finish next time. But you can see how the painting kind of just slowly comes out of the muck, out of the you know, the watercolory feel starts to become, an opaqueness starts to occur, and the painting starts to look more, you know, like an actual painting. Not that gouache or a thinned out watercolory type painting isn't a painting, I mean, it totally is. I'm just saying, for what I'm trying to accomplish, I want combinations of watercolor and opaqueness. And I was really amazed to see at the Zorn show, Andrew Zorn show, his watercolors, how much gouache he uses in them. It's amazing. I mean, it's a lot more than I thought, which made me feel good, because I almost cried when I saw how, you know, I mean, when I used to see his reproductions in books and magazines, it was so good. It was like, oh my God, you know? But then you see the originals, which doesn't discredit any of me. It feels good that he's not planning all those perfect whites in his water. He's actually putting them in with overlay of gouache, which is a lot easier, that's for sure. If you have to plan out every white perfectly, oh my God, it's like, make your head explode. How careful you have to be to get that to work. So if any of you guys are coming out for the Comic Con, it'll be coming up pretty soon. I'll be demoing there. Just a little demo about the online school. We've done that, I don't know, we've done the Comic Con for 18 years or 19 years or something like that. A long time. But it's a cool, if you're ever out for it, it's a really neat event as far as bringing a lot of the great visual development, conceptor, comic guys together in one place. And it's now become such an incredibly diverse con that it's really more of an all-encompassing tech con rather than comics. It's hardly comics anymore. It's mostly, you know, movies and animation and gaming and things like that, which I think is, you know, great. They're all great areas, so I don't... But I still have a romantic remembrance of what it was like when it was mostly comic-driven. When I went when I was a little kid with my dad, and when I was probably 7, and it was like, you know, it was like 20 guys in there with old crates of comics, and it was really, truly the Comic Con back then. Now it's the, you know, Tech Con. Okay, let's see. So I'm going back with my water, and I'm going over some of my shapes in the water to aggravate them, and some of them to simplify, some to blend them together, looking for some happy accidents, looking for... doing some water glazing, which is kind of, again, a poor man's airbrush. So I'm going in and, you know, again, I'll do some airbrushing, but not yet. Next time, we'll get in and do a fair amount. I got a quiet bunch today. Good. Again, yeah, this is, you know, it's hard to show people when you go through breaking down shapes and they look not so great or they look kind of ugly or whatever. But that's, every painting goes through that stage. I don't think you could make it where every shape looks perfect the whole way through. It's just not the way painting works. But knowing that a shape doesn't quite look the way you want it to for whatever reason, it's too curved, it's too straight, it's too this, is really important. And that's something that again, we'll try to cultivate over time as you watch me do things, as you watch Eric or Lucas or you're studying with us and we're showing you time and time again, you'll get it. It'll resonate with you. I mean, some people just are not going to be good colorists no matter what they do. It's just the way it is. It's you know, they're going to be tonalists, so they're going to be this or that. If that happens to be you, it is what it is, you know? I mean, it doesn't mean don't try, but I mean, it's kind of like saying I want to be a really lean, long-distance runner, and I'm, you know, built like a tank. How do I change my body type to that? And then how do I get it to even be able to do that? It's so out of my what I'm capable of. You know, so there are times when you have to kind of just say, yeah, I'm just not built for that. You know, just, you know, I'm better with tone, you know. So... all of us have to deal with certain things like that. All of us are going to have our little fortes, our little things we're good at, and all of us are going to have other things that we struggle with. That's why when you're in a classroom environment, don't compete with anybody, because, you know, some guy might be smoking you and drawing, you know, and doing great, but then when he gets to color, or she gets to color, they don't have a good color sense. And you happen to have a really decent natural color sense, so you just fly right past them in, when you're studying that. Again, it's not all about the competition. It's just saying that people have different strengths. And we have to accept those, I think, and be a little more receptive to saying, okay, let's not avoid our weaknesses, but let's not pander to our strengths, but let's work our weaknesses as best we can, and let's recognize what our true strengths are, and then let's work intelligently between those two things so that we can, you know, do as good as we can. You're always probably going to want to do what you're not very good at. If you're like most people I know, if you've got curly hair, you want straight. If you're big build, you want to be skinny. If you're skinny, you want to be muscular. Always seems like everybody always wants to have something they don't naturally have. So a lot of times you can kind of tell what you're not good at, because, well, I'm not saying always, but sometimes it'll be the things that I most wish I wanted to do. And I look at it and go, God, it's because I'm not really that good at that I want to do that so bad. Doesn't mean I don't try, but I just recognize that it's not a true strength of mine. Going in. I think sculpting, I mean, I'm decent at sculpting, but am I as good at sculpting as I am at representing things on a flat surface three-dimensionally? No. It's a lot harder work for me. I'm not quite wired that three-dimensionally as some people are. But the people that are have a hard time drawing and painting a lot of times, too. So yeah, they can take a piece of clay and do something really cool, but you give them a piece of paper and say, now make it look three-dimensional, and they struggle immensely doing that. So it doesn't demean them or make them any less of an artist. It's just different. Okay, we've got about 10 minutes left, so I'm just going to paint right through and keep pecking around on it. Having a lot of fun. It's really quite, you know, it's fun to build this old painting. It's what I had sitting in the back, you know, and I was looking for something to paint for today, and I was thinking, okay, you know, I'm leaving tomorrow, I got a lot of stuff going on, I didn't have a lot of time to search through and prepare, so I found this piece that I had kind of sketched out years ago when I was doing more narrative work, and I had never really done it, so I thought, you know, that's kind of a fun one, let's get in and work on that a little bit and see if we can explain some concepts using this as a springboard for those concepts. So no airbrush yet. Later, for finishing touches, and you know, it'll be good. It'll have its place, and you guys will get a kick out of it, I think, watching it when we do it. I haven't really got to a lot of the water yet. That'll be the thickest, one of the thickest areas of paint application is in that cascading water. And we'll want to kind of get the illusion of pushing some of the rock up under, you know, through it and stuff. So it's going to be a lot of, we'll start with our stains like we have, and then we'll slowly build up, and then I'll show you as we go. But it'll be a lot of fun. Get a little bit of purples in there. We can get some just stains. Now the water, the rock that's under the water is usually pretty dark because it's so wet that it might be the same color. It probably most likely is the same color as what's out in the light areas, which is more of a ruddy reddish, peachy kind of tone. But because it's so soaking wet, it's taking on a very dark neutral tone. So these are some of the rocks that are, you know, kind of poking through as the water comes over them. So you see me kind of put the tone down and whisk with my finger, and it's kind of a way to dry brush show that kind of some of that activity of the moving water coming over. And it's just a cheap, easy, fast way to get that illusion, start getting that illusion. Always have fun. Always try to inject fun into the equation if possible. I know at times you'll just be so beside yourself because something's not coming out that you'll want to scream. And if it helps, go ahead. I don't, you know, sometimes I'll run around the studio like a banshee. Just so frustrated with something that's not working out. Usually that's the time for me to take a break and go for a run or go work out, go lift weights, go pound weights or something. Something that I could just get my frustration out in a healthy way. That's going to be nice because next time I can leisurely bring it up to a really, really strong comp finish, which will give you, you know, and maybe I'll dig some old ones out to show you as well. I mean, if you look through Frazetta's Roughworks book, which was a little book he put out on all of his gouache comps for his larger paintings, a lot of his most famous paintings were in there. He was a good gouache painter too, and he used it in the same way I use it now, which is as a preliminary idea generation medium.
Hey Jeff, we have a question
mm-hmm.
from Justin H. You said you need someone with a correct eye to see what mistakes you made. Unfortunately, at the moment, I don't have someone to see what's wrong. What's the best way to self-correct your drawing? You are awesome, by the way.
Well, thanks. I mean, I don't have an easy answer for that because obviously it's kind of a catch-22. If the eye could already see what the problems were, it wouldn't be making the problems, right? So a lot of times if you're making certain issues, the eye is unable to obviously see them. And that's where a very dangerous position to be in because, you're basically unable to see properly. In that situation, the best you can do is surround yourself by good videos, good books, do the online school if you can. That way, at least you're seeing the good work constantly going in your brain. Again, if you don't have, you know, the $99 a month to do that or whatever, you're in a precarious position. You know, I don't have an easy answer for you. It's just one of those things you've got to be around good eyes. Try to get into the best class you can. Try to get a group of guys together. Try to, find the best people you can glue yourself to. Good books will help. They're a far cry from watching live action stuff happen, but they are the next best thing. So good books will help.
That's stepping away from the painting.
Yeah, you can look at the painting backwards. You can use a little mirror and look at it and flip it. That way it flips it backwards. You can kind of see if there's any asymmetries in the composition or if there's proportional errors that will jump out that you weren't able to see. Because when you're working on a painting for a while, your eye kind of goes a little bit numb, almost like snow blind, like if you're out in the snow and you can't see after a while. You're blinded, literally. So when you're working on a painting for many, many, many hours, many days, you can't even see what right is anymore. It's so hard. So you got to take some breaks from it. You got to get away from it. It's always, I like to have a couple paintings going at the same time, or I like to switch between drawing and painting and doing different disciplines. That way I can also keep a fresh eye. So there are little things you can do. My best suggestion again would be a video tutorial course like ours or any other new masters, I don't know any of those, try different ones, see which ones work best for you. I would say that for a lot of you out there that are struggling in areas where there aren't ateliers in your back pocket, something like our online program, and again, it does sound like a sales pitch, and I don't mind selling something that I believe entirely in that is awesome, and it is awesome, and it would help a lot. So if you can do that, do it. I wish you the best of luck. It's hard. I understand what you're up against. Just do the best you can. That's all you can do. Try to surround yourself with the best people and try to get the best information into your brain through video or books, if possible. Or actually an actual school, but that might mean moving somewhere like San Diego or Florence or somewhere that may just monetarily be completely out of your ability level. If that's the case, then it is what it is. It's something you'll just have to kind of try to slowly work your way out of. And with enough interest, you'll make it. You'll find a way. It's amazing what you can do when you put your heart into it and you're really interested in something. You may have a lot of naysayers, family members, people closest to you that are kind of poo-pooing the idea and, oh my God, you're going to starve and I can't believe you want to be an artist and all this stuff. And that just only should add to your resolve, add to your strengthening of you becoming the person, your own person. You know, at some point you got to cut the umbilical cord and get out there and do your thing, you know. And if the parents are behind you, great. If they're not, sometimes you got to go it on your own. But, you know, again, it's one of those things where if you want it bad enough, you'll find a way. I know a lot of people that have struggled through schooling and taken out, you know, chances and stuff. Just make the best educated decision you can is all I can say. And do a lot of due diligence and a lot of research before you make those tough decisions. So I think we're kind of wrapping it up here, you guys. I wanted to finish it. I think I was a little overzealous with that idea. But I will finish it next, probably in 2 weeks from now. So if you want to tune back in and see me bring this up to as finished as I can do a comp, that's my goal. So it'll be like a 6-hour comp, which is pretty cool. Yeah, but it is a pretty complicated little guy, and it's not uncommon for me to spend, if I was not talking and I was just painting and I was blown through it, it might be a 3 or 4 hour little painting. Maybe one day's worth of work, or, you know, I could probably get the comp done, and that would be I would feel really good about that. So anyway, thanks for joining, and again, tune in 2 weeks and we'll finish this one off. Alrighty, thanks a bunch, and I'll see you around. They're good?
Yeah, we'll let them look at it for a few minutes.
Yeah, that's cool. All right.
Good job.
Yeah, it's fun. Wish I could have got more done, but oh well.
That's the way it goes.
Good on the screen.
Mm-hmm. One person was saying that it looked a little blue shifted, so we can mess with that next time.
Yeah.
Because it's maybe a little cooler light.
Yeah, I think than what we usually use.
Yeah.
What is going on over here, Jeff?
No, down on that.
What's
up? Down on that 30 yards.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that one I just finished up a while ago. You want to grab it, pick it up carefully. It's getting ready. I don't know if it'll go, I put it in a show. I mean, I submitted it. I don't know if it'll be in
there. Everyone sent me some things right now.
Oh, okay. Well, then should I say something?
No, you don't.
Okay, that's nice.
And then they're saying also that some people like the Wednesday slot.
Oh, yeah. Instead of, so you can put it up here if you want. Put
it on this one.
Should work. Okay, I'm gonna shut it down. Okay. That one is. Yeah, so it's. Yeah.
What shows are going for?
I submitted to the Impressionist Society show.
Nice.
Craig Beck the third is gonna be judging, so that's kind of cool.
The third?
No, the third. When you have the third behind you,
you're
dangerous.
Not the
second? Yeah. But you guys are a good painter. Quite good. So, I don't know. I hope it gets in. Cool. If not, I'll put it in some other show. Or I like the painting overall. It's a little tighter than I normally paint, but I don't know. It's hard to loosen up much more on stuff like that.
Yeah.
Looking really
yeah,
good. Yeah, I mean, at some point, you got to say, I can't just let everything go totally squirrely. So, yeah, it's kind of fun. Yeah, she was a good model. Cool.
Did she model at the school?
No, she's a friend of ours. She used to model for me. She has 2 kids now, and that was years ago, like 7 years ago, 8 years ago. But she just actually commented on it. She